It's Wednesday, the 28th day of September, 2016. I'm your host, Alex Jones. And in just three short days, the internet will be handed over by the United States that built it in conjunction with the UK. It will be handed over the control, the address registries, the domain DNSs will be handed over to a global UN-run consortium. Our election this year will be overseen by the OECD's intelligence body. The OECD is the corporation that began the European Union. It is the European robber barons, the actual corporation. And Obama comes out last week and says we need to surrender control of U.S. sovereignty to the U.N. But we should cue that clip back up because I don't come up with themes for the show. What's happening creates the theme. I have a stack of mainstream news here where the United Nations is going after Sheriff Opio, where the United Nations is going after the Texas state government, where in the Washington Post, the mouth of Surin, U.S. owes black people reparations for the history of racial terrorism, says UN panel. Now understand, the human rights panel of the UN is run by Saudi Arabia and Qatar that still say that black people aren't humans and have them basically as slaves in many areas. I mean, you cannot make this up. This is an outside global power, just like the George Soros emails say, using racial and cultural and religious differences to play us off against each other. And you can see how they plan to bring down the U.S., get us all to say we're kumbaya, bring in political correctness, then hype up massive racist behavior by so-called minorities, force feed it in schools, and then have a global system where it's managed and where the U.N. represents the, quote, third world populations that are then brought into the first world for colonial reparations carried out by the very robber barons and royalty engaging in the reverse colonialism of the West right now, playing different sides off against each other. This is the equation that you were just given. It is unbelievable. We've got the Smart Cities Initiative to bring our internet under UN control. We have the strong cities to bring our local police under UN control. You cannot make it up. They're announcing it. So do I get a Pulitzer Prize for breaking all this 20 years ago? No. I'm even more kooky. I'm even more dark-hearted. I'm even more dangerous, according to Hillary and according to her VP candidate, Tim Kaine. I've got to be shut down. I don't have a right to exist. Now, I want to explain something. Michael Savage has 20 million listeners a week. He came on the show twice in the last month, and they manipulated him. They cut him off WABC, let him know he was being taunted. Then they began cutting him off his 400 affiliates. They could have just flipped the satellite off. But they did it over an hour as people called in saying you're slowly being turned off at the station level to drive him into a fit. Now, I've got his home number and his cell number. He's not been answering. I talked to his producer yesterday, and he said, well, we're just trying to figure out what's going on. CBS won't even tell us. You'll hear something soon. But this is a bellwether for everybody. He told me last week during the break that he might not be on the air soon because he was being censored more and more by CBS. So let's understand that. Michael Savage told me that last week in front of my producers on Skype during the break, talking to him right here in this chair. So this affects everybody. They just took over Fox News. And I told you 2 months ago, get ready for talk radio next. 40 days out, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for joining us on this Wednesday, the 28th day of September 2016. We have several very informative guests joining us. One of them is Mr. Crowder of Louder with Crowder. Always informative and interesting. Stephen Crowder from louderwithcrowder.com will be joining us. Dr. Ed Grubb's going to be joining us, talking about this story, exclusive, Time Magazine. And then I went and looked, and the news had actually broken 3 days ago in the New Scientist, but whatever, I just love how time lies incessantly. World's first baby born with new three-parent technique. And, of course, the story that really broke was 9 months ago that the woman was pregnant, and then a few days ago that the woman was going into labor. But yes, I guess it is exclusive that the baby's been born. And I don't want to go off the reservation. The point is, there were hundreds of articles that broke before Time Magazine said this, and none of them said exclusive. It's just ridiculous how they always spin and deceive at every level. And they sell it like it's this wonderful new thing. We're going to be talking about that a lot more today. Also, there's pretty exclusive, conclusive video. It's not exclusive. Everybody's got it, thank God. And that's, did Hillary Clinton give hand signals to debate moderator Lester Holt? You watch the 7.5-minute video up on Infowars.com. It's very conclusive. It's like somebody in a poker game clearly giving signals. And then every time she would do it, he would continue with the topic if it was on one side of her nose. The other side of her nose, he would then immediately interrupt Donald Trump 40-plus times, her only 6 times. So this is just ridiculous. I mean, she might as well have been sending smoke signals up or something, or sending him text messages. So absolutely rigged. It blew up in their face. I think Trump should have been more aggressive. He says he will be in the next debate. I think he knows that he could have done a better job. But it doesn't matter. They totally rigged the thing, and so they lose. And that's what the poll numbers are showing. So they can't win for losing. That's coming up. We have got so much to get into on the continued persecution of anyone that actually tries to bring jobs to the United States. The weaponized government continues. U.S. Department of Labor targets Peter Thiel. And again, he attends Bilderberg Group, but he does a lot of good things, though. I think the jury's out on one of the founders of, obviously, PayPal, Facebook, you name it. But Peter Thiel's startup sued by Department of Labor for discrimination, saying he doesn't hire enough Asians. Yes, Asians are being discriminated against in high tech, and I guess in PhDs, and I guess in doctorates, even though Asians have the highest percentage in that and are the richest people, basically, in this country in the wide aggregate. But, oh, the white people are out to get them, you see, ladies and gentlemen, those evil, evil, evil white people. And this is all because they're angry because he came out, you know, as being gay at the RNC, and Donald Trump said it's time to have a big tent and be inclusive, and it was a huge coup against Hillary, and they're totally upset, and so they're trying to destroy his company. That's just how they operate. It's what they do. Also, on the economic front, China debt could wreck the global economy. Leading economist warns country could suffer a calamitous slowdown, and I think that slowdown's already clearly happening. That's one of the big triggers we're looking at. Now, before I get into all of the massive amounts of critical news that we have today, I want to just lay a marker down here that this issue that I'm about to break down is undoubtedly the most central issue facing every man, woman, and child on this globe right now. Global private corporate governance is now standing on its own 2 feet. It's gone from being embryonic to being a baby, to crawling, to standing, to walking. It's now running. It's now a young man. It's now basically ready to start its life as an adult, as an operating system, not as beta, but as 1.0. As I said back on September 1st, everything locked in place. It was very clear. Their entire program accelerated 200% the week before and that first week. All hell broke loose. Their programs launched. You could see the integration, whether it was Apple or whether it was Facebook or whether it was Google or whether it was Bing. You could see it on the Microsoft platforms. Everywhere, the new look came in, the new notifications, the new style, the new operating systems, the new upgrade. It all went into place, unified continuity of agenda. Very, very, very chilling. And the UN came out suddenly all over multinational news, all over our news, and said, the UN is going to run your borders. The UN is running the immigration program for the US and Europe. The UN is going to go after right-wing extremists. The UN is going to take over the internet. They'd always denied it. They said it was just a multinational transfer, but we still have control. Oh, now they, admit the New York Times. Yes, the UN's taking over. Thank God. Hurry up and censor these right-wingers. and massive censorship intensified in Europe, and civil emergencies were declared, and radical Islamists were brought in, and UN TV ads air in Sweden, France, and Germany saying, it's good to not be German, blonde hair is bad, it's racist, German families are bad, you need to wear the hijab, you need to marry a Muslim man. I mean, I've aired the TV ads. I've shown you the parenting magazines. I mean, this isn't some little fringe kook group doing this. This is UNESCO, the United Nations Educational and Cultural Organization, which our universities, our high schools, everything is standardized and set to their regulations. The federal regulations are written to meet that, not our laws, but what the UN says. They launched in the last 6 months, strong cities, admitted takeover of our local governments by the United Nations, enforced by the Justice Department. Obama administration and UN announced global police force to fight extremism in the U.S. Today in the news, U.S. owes black people reparations for a history of racial terrorism, says UN panel. The UN all over Africa to create carbon offsets will go in with troops. This has been even in the New York Times, and kill whole villages, sometimes thousands in a week, to take them off their ancestral lands and, quote, set it aside for a carbon sink when multinational corporations go in and want to take the property. But they're going to tell Europe and the United States, and by the way, the UK ended slavery pretty much worldwide, except for in the Middle East, that we owe reparations and that we ancestrally owe other people money. That's like if your dad's a murderer and then you go to prison for it. Well, how about your great-great-grandfather or great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather going back to slavery? Now it's the UN saying you will pay reparations, manipulating internal groups within our nation, with Soros, with Hillary, with the Justice Department coming in to manage the local police departments under UN control. This is the Washington Post today. It's up on Infowars.com. There is an entire section on DrudgeReport.com that breaks all of this down. This is happening. This is unfolding. This is real. Now, I want to be clear. When October 1st comes around in 3 days, okay, they're going to have TV shows and they're going to have newspapers say crazy people in Congress and crazy people online thought the UN would end the internet. Look, the internet's still here today. Birds are tweeting. The sun's out. We never said that. We said the regulation and the control is going in and that they're going to phase all this control in and that they're going to announce more and more UN control in the months and years to come. And you see it all happening. Now, 2 or 3 years, total UN takeover, that seems like a long time. That's a flash. Now, let's go to this report with Michael Savage being taken off the air and how this affects everyone. And it's part of a global government takeover. Here it is.
Those who stay, cross over the line.
We're back on the air. Apparently, there was a glitch. We think there was a technical glitch. I kind of doubt it. So if you want to know if there's media bias tonight, you don't have to look any further than this show. 100 million viewers, and on the eve of the most important debate in history, they take off a man like me. Not so much as an email to my producer before the show. Did my syndicator send a note saying they were preempting me today? So the only reason they preempted me is to prevent me from talking about Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, in my estimation. And I'm going to make a statement right now. If they do this to me again tomorrow, and they did it to me, by the way, without any notice, make a note of this because you may not hear me tomorrow or ever again. I want you to understand the kind of duress I'm under. This is sabotage. Do you understand what sabotage is? Those of you who are listening, understand very clearly, if perhaps for the first time, that the fairness doctrine is already in operation on WABC in New York.
It was a year ago that the reclusive Matt Drudge of DrudgeReport.com visited Austin, Texas with an unannounced emergency message for our listeners.
I had a Supreme Court justice tell me to my face, it's over for me. I said, Matt, it's over for you. They've got the votes now to enforce copyright law. You're out of there. They're going to make it so headlines, you can't even use headlines. To have a Supreme Court justice say that to my face, that it's over, They've got the votes, which means time is limited. Time is not forever. How many more moons and sunrises will you see in your life? Rise and fall. There's not that many. It's a small amount. So for people to be saying with this attitude, oh, I'll get on with my life and my greatness sometime.
No.
No, you can't.
We're being enslaved now, and that's it. Under the TPP, they admit you can't put a headline to the New York Times. You're sending massive traffic to them. They're claiming you're taking their words. This is insane.
And you had the Justice Stephen Breyer said we need to look at a global law. Now, remember just recently
getting lined up with it.
So they're getting ready for these decisions to come. You thought Obamacare was shocking. You thought some of these other decisions were shocking. Wait until these copyright laws work their way up and the Supreme Court decides you cannot have a website with news headlines linking across the board.
In just 4 days, the domain registry system and the internet IP address program will be handed over to a multinational consortium headed up by the United Nations and the Communist Chinese. The Communist Chinese are the biggest censors in the world and execute people that peacefully practice Buddhism. And this is who Facebook and Google and Twitter and Apple and others are working with. This is the new consortium that will decide the future rules of the internet. Because whether it's China or areas in Africa, more and more poor people are now getting on the internet in these countries, and those nations are finding it near impossible to completely censor that information. So what they're doing is coming to the United States and Europe and asking those governments to set up systems to censor the information promoting freedom before it gets to those other countries. Because if Obama's going to tell Africans you can't have air conditioning or cars, Americans can't have air conditioning or cars, or at least Africans shouldn't be able to see that.
Ultimately, if you think about all the youth that everybody's mentioned here in Africa, if everybody's raising living standards to the point where everybody's got a car and everybody's got air conditioning and everybody's got a big house, well, the planet will boil over.
Just last week, I had the former technical leader of the NSA on William Binning, and he said clearly, this is a corporate system establishing world government through the surveillance grid and the takeover of the internet. What's the master strategy on building this technocracy? I mean, do they have one?
I think it's this is my impression, okay? Certainly, it is population control. But not just of any given country, but of the world. And so what they're after in direct, and I think Obama has stated this from various points, that he wanted a world community. So I think that's probably what they're after. In order to do that, they have to be able to control the people of the world. So in order to do that, you have to have knowledge of them to know who's doing what so you can stop it or manipulate it any way you want.
William Binney, that is the most profound thing I think I've ever heard you say, and you've said a lot of profound things. This is the key for a technocracy world government program, and Davos admits that's their plan, but here you are, the former leader of the National Security Agency, telling us that that's what they're building. And I haven't heard you talk about world government being the objective, but I mean, it clearly is. Can you elaborate with your geopolitical and geospatial and technical understanding?
Yeah, well, I see, that's the problem. The technology has made this all possible. I mean, we could easily follow 12 to 20 billion phone calls a day. It's, like 10 million people moving around every day is trivial. That's a trivial issue. So all of that could be done by technology, and yet they're claiming something is really difficult, when in fact it's not.
Obama's czars are now openly calling for the return of the fairness doctrine, where you can't have any political opinion on talk radio. They've been targeting talk radio sponsors. They have been going after my show. And just as Dr. Drew was pulled off the air for saying, hey, Hillary's clearly got medical problems. What she's being prescribed is deadly when you mix the drugs together. I want to help her. He was fired 1 week later.
There are two other things that gravely concerned us. When she hit her head, she had to wear these prism glasses when she came out.
Right.
That is brain damage, and so that, and it's affecting her balance. Now, clearly it hasn't affected her cognition, but tell us a little more about that.
And now, Michael Savage, yesterday, was first taken off WABC in New York. When the host began to gloat that it was a coup against him on air, Savage got word and began to basically criticize what was happening and was taken off 400-plus affiliates nationwide by CBS.
Not only have I been sabotaged in the largest market that I have, it's clear sabotage because the two geniuses that they're using to fill in for me who have ratings that are about 40% lower than mine are gloating on the air that they've conducted a coup against Savage, right on the air. Because I spent 30 minutes talking about Hillary's health problems. I read you every fact about it. I then read you the pharmacology of levodopa, which is the main drug for Parkinson's. And right in the middle of that discussion of levodopa and its side effects, I was cut off across the country. Now, I don't know how much longer this is going to hold up right now in the studio in which I'm broadcasting from.
Military style. He's pulled off WABC first. The decision is made where CBS is based in New York. Then he's taken off 30 minutes later from his 400 stations across the country. And he's sitting there in San Francisco with his headphones in his studio, broadcasting to no one for at least 10 minutes before he discovers that he's been taken off the air. And then he was told, you're basically done. Ladies and gentlemen, this is about a free press. Regardless of what you think about Michael Savage, love him or hate him, this is an attack on the very fundamental bedrock of this nation. This is 21st century book burning that's taking place. Dr. Savage came on the show twice in the last 2 weeks to talk about the dire straits of this country. And during several breaks last week, while I was talking to him via Skype from my studio, he was telling me that he was concerned that this could be the last book he publishes, and that basically he was being censored by CBS, and that he wanted to air the interview that he and I were having because we just had a powerful segment on his show. And I said, well, air whatever you want. He said, no, I know. But now CBS is telling me I can't air your show. I'm getting really massive heat from up on top. So he said, look, the country's in trouble. They're coming after our free speech. We went back on air, finished the segment. He was gone. I've called him today, haven't been able to get in touch with him, and now he's off the air. I mean, this could happen to us just like that, because this is the season we're in of tyranny. This is the climate in our nation. Michael Savage said it himself. He's very proud to be the test case. They've gone after him first. And if they can get away with this, they can get away with shutting everybody off. We stand together or we hang separate. In closing, I want to ask viewers and listeners this paramount question. What is your line in the sand? The censorship, the control is all suddenly being phased in. They're going from beta to 1.0 right now. And the fight is happening. A year in political time is like the blink of an eye. And in the next year, we're going to see the attempt to shut down free speech and bully the American people and others into submission. Already in Europe, they arrest you if you criticize the open borders and the Islamic invasion. The mayor of London just assigned a police unit to arrest people that criticize Islam even mildly. You add this to all the other things that are happening, it is crisis level. We are facing 21st century warfare. It's being conducted by mega banks, huge corporations, using giant migrant flows and collapsing third world populations that have been abused by this very system to bring down what's left of the West. Because the globalists see prosperity and independence as competition. They see the West and any form of wealth and individuals controlling just a small part of their destiny as a threat. That's why this tyranny is the greatest tyranny humanity's ever faced. And that's why all of us are now Michael Savage. All of us are now Spartacus. Spartacus was the famous Roman slave gladiator who led a revolt and almost toppled the Roman Empire. And it's a true story that they were killing thousands of the revolting slaves, saying, we're Spartacus, we're Spartacus. They would all say, I'm Spartacus. Well, I don't want to say I'm jealous because it's a very dangerous position he's in, but the fact that they came for Michael Savage first really sets him into a very special category. They're very scared of him. And they've told me they're coming for us next. We're already under a lot of pressure. We need your prayers and support. We're harder to shut down because we self-syndicate. We work on a lot of other internet platforms. But we're in some very dark waters. So we're all Michael Savage now. And if you don't stand with him, and if you don't stand against 21st century book burning, it's going to be your views and your ideas that are banned next. So I hope everybody shares this report with everybody they know, because this isn't just America's fight. This is the world's fight. And we're seeing the fall of our republic right now if these people carrying this out are successful. I'm Alex Jones, signing off from the InfoWars News Center, however long it lasts, in Austin, Texas. Just reminding all of you that are out there watching that you really are the hope to turn this around. You are the resistance. The time has come. Begin the shutdown. We're 40 days out from the historic election. And whether Trump wins or loses, we win, because he's promoting nationalism, populism, anti-political correct behavior that shows everyone it's okay to speak out. It's okay to stand up. It's okay to be who you are. Let me do this. Let me just read to you headlines today that are from all my different stacks. World News, Economy, InfoWars, Drudge, you name it. And look at the theme. It's open world government. It's our nations having to do what the UN and multinational corporations say. In fact, can we cue up Obama's 1 minute, 20-second clip from the UN last week again, where he called for global government? And he says, we need to give up our sovereignty. He says, believe me, I have trouble with my fellow Americans getting them to understand international standards, as if foreign countries are running the U.S. It's globalists that are running the U.S., the same ones that have run those nations into the ground, because they don't follow the same rules. They're exempt from almost everything they foist on us. And they sit back and call themselves geniuses because they've hijacked the world economy and because they're consolidating such wealth. But they're so greedy, they never even put infrastructure back in for the general public. And as a rule of hand, they try to dumb us down as much as possible and use weaponized media to keep us in the dark so we can be more easily managed. And finally, you see in the Associated Press and you see in the Hollywood Reporter what we've been telling you for at least a decade, and that is now even in the London Guardian and the New York Times. Almost every billionaire has run to the hills in Australia or New Zealand. Almost every major billionaire has basically fitted out giant yachts with 3, 4, 5 years of food on board and fully automatic weapons and rocket launchers. And they're not doing it out of hysteria or fear. Some of these billionaires started their own companies. They're really smart. They're good people. Others were the children and grandchildren of robber barons. But they are escaping. Hundreds of articles a week. Chicago Tribune, headline, the rich are fleeing Chicago. Millionaires are leaving Chicago, report. They just try to run out to the countryside, put a fence up around their yard, put in well water and a wind turbine, maybe some solar. But the really rich people, I told the story 6 years ago of going and filing some corporations, which you do for every new film or, you know, new venture you put out for liability protection. And I'm there in this big fancy law firm, never been there before. I'm just there to file some papers. Attractive lady walks over, older lady, but attractive, and says, you know who I am? I'm like, no, I don't know who you are. She says, well, I'm a big listener, and I'm selling everything I got, and I'm, you know, moving out of the United States. She told me where she was going. She said, you can talk about this, just don't say who I am. Look, you know, look up who I am later. Even 6 years ago, you know, the iPhones were so slow, I didn't check it in my pocket. And then I did, but you know, the business I hadn't left, and I Googled her that night at home, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is a lady that's one of the biggest owners of a defense contractor company. This is a lady that owns all these big banking firms, admittedly worth tens of billions of dollars. And for like 15 minutes, she told me, she said, there won't be a U.S. in 4, 5, or 6 years. Now, that's 6 years ago. And I said, what do you mean? She said, what do I mean? It's everything you say, but I've confirmed it at the highest levels. And everybody else is getting out of here. And I said, well, what's going to happen? She goes, you know? And she said, you need to get ready to get really famous and really successful. And I said, what do you mean? And she said, buddy, you got it. And when all this stuff starts happening, you are going to have credibility that is stratospheric. Now, I've told that story since that happened. And now here we are, and it's all happening. And things always take a little longer than people think. And I wish she was wrong. But panic, anxiety spark, rush to build luxury bunkers for L.A. super rich. Let me tell you, L.A. goes upside down. No bunker's going to keep you safe. That is the last place you want to be on Earth. You do not want to be there. We should get, you know what? It's time to fly Joel Skousen back here. I mean, he flies himself, pilot. It's time to tell him I'll pay for the fuel for to fly him here in his jet or fly him here commercial. I want to get Skousen here to maybe shoot a new special report, you know, mini documentary. We've already made one film with him, Strategic Relocation, and that was about 4 years ago because things are really, really starting to boil over, obviously. Now, I said I'd mention headlines. Let me just do that right now. U.S. owes black people reparations for a history of racial terrorism, says UN panel, headed up by the Saudi Arabians, who are the most abusive on Earth after North Korea. Oh, I'm sorry. That's the Washington Post. London is open. Mayor Khan vows to defy Brexit and offer city visas to immigrants. He supports the EU. He supports the UN. He says he will ignore federal law and he will ignore the parliament, just as the EU does, and he will bring in the illegals and the jihadis himself. That is express.co.uk. Remember, this isn't Alex Jones. I told you months ago he was going to open the borders up and bring everybody in and create a Lundistan. He's now announcing it. We know the plan. Before we got Soros' emails 5 weeks ago, we already knew the plan. It was word for word what we already knew. You can see it. Soros says we're going to bring in giant, incompatible groups, break society down, bring in civil emergency over the top of that, and then segregate everybody and control everyone with that divide and conquer stratagem. The Clintons call it the broken coalition strategy. I mean, boom, here it is, UN, Islamic mayor. It goes on and on. Obama administration and UN announced global police force to fight extremism in U.S., run by the UN. DHS accidentally legalized 750 immigrants just magically, who had just shown up. And, of course, they just magically bus them in, fly them in, all the rest of it. That's just because Obama has the UN, you see, running this program with the founder of the EU, Peter Sutherland, as the head of the EU Borders and Migrant Bureau. That's their new 21st century weapon. This is the attack. Obama administration wants to surrender U.S. control of the internet to global bureaucracy. That's from months ago. I wanted to point that out. It happens in 3 days. Donald Trump came out just 5 days ago and said, or 6 days ago, and signaled opposition to handing internet control to the United Nations. Well, sorry, they hand them the DNS servers, the codes, the address systems, where they can disappear anybody they want off the web where no one else can find you. And that's just a nuclear option to what's already happening with Google and Microsoft and Apple and Facebook, where they only direct you to news you want. My iPhone broke, so I said, get me a new one to the crew. They got me a 7, I guess the new one, and I'm actually going to turn it back in and get an older one. And I've said I need to get rid of them, but I am a media person. I am a journalist. I really do work on it. I know it's evil, but my good, I think, outweighs it. But still, I can't preach against these little computers that track us and follow us and control us if I'm sitting here using one. But I was on it for hours last night. When someone calls you and does a voicemail without you asking it to, it transcripts what they said. And that's NSA technology, old technology. But they're just incorporating it all in our face, making it ubiquitous. And everything about it would just launch news that was Salon and New York Times and Washington Post and in the news feeds. It was all bashing Trump. So I search engine myself in the news it kept redirecting me to. Wouldn't even say what it was. It was just directing me to it. And it was all attack pieces for dozens of pages of links, just everything bad about Alex Jones, every distortion, every lie. This is the technocracy that we see forcing you into their internet ghettos that Matt Drudge talked about. So there's the news on that front. Cadell calls out stupidity of Republicans in internet takeover debate. It's another sign of America selling out. And that's absolutely what's happening. The Republicans are going along with it, just like they do TPP and the rest of it, because they're getting bought off. You know, crooks in the old days just robbed banks. Now they just sell out our infrastructure. And then the UN admits they're going to censor us under their new policies, and they're already beta testing all that. Panic, anxiety spark, rush to build luxury bunkers. I mentioned that, and it ties into China. Debt could wreck the global economy. Leading economist warns country could suffer a calamitous slowdown. Now, let's talk about this. I have asked my crew, this is something that's fallen through the cracks over the years, to go back and find news clips on YouTube and to go back and find news articles. I mean, I can remember some of the headlines myself. And to just do a little news piece showing this, where we told you 5 years ago when they were debating Obamacare that the version that passed have death panels, have rationing of care, and you can't keep your doctor most of the time, and it does double and triple your prices, and that there are penalties of up to $5,000 per person and your employer. Now, I'm experiencing it with the CPAs and the law firms right now, where I have basically 50 employees and I've got some contractors. And so by law, $5,000 fine per person and my employees, $5,000 fines. They've been ratcheting up the last few years. Run by the IRS, who hired 18,000 new people in the Obamacare bill to enforce it. So I said, this is a tax, and it's not evenly laid on people because Obama can give thousands of companies waivers to not have to get Obamacare, like McDonald's. So then, you know, your hamburger chain goes under, it's got to pay for it, but McDonald's doesn't. The whole thing's discriminatory. And there are news clips with Rachel Maddow and others saying, I'm deeply racist, I'm hateful, I'm bad, I'm evil, I'm lying about our first black president, saying that this thing has fines and fees. I remember a story 2 years ago when the fines were starting to kick in at certain levels. Now, this year, it kicks in on everybody. And I remember the headlines everywhere. Matt Drudge caught lying. Drudge lies. There is no Obamacare penalty. Remember Drudge said, I'm not trying to obsess on Drudge. This is what happened. I mean, this is in the news. This is an example. Just Drudge is in the news all over the place. That's why we talk about Drudge every 5 minutes. And it's not a Drudge obsession. It's just like, it's a fact. There's lots of sand at the seashore, folks. You know, that's what we're building sandcastles with here. And so Drudge comes out and says and tweets, I'm going to just, you know, basically pay the fine. I'm not getting Obamacare. I'm not being forced to do what you want and going out to some, you know, big, you know, scam computer site where the insurance companies pass me around like a $2 whore. That's what they do. The exchange is what they call it. Boy, I spent days on that thing getting insurance last year because I was kicked off my insurance by Obamacare that I'd had for 18 years. Oh, and by the way, it doubled the first year. But get this, we can show where they said there is no penalty, there is no tax. Racist Republicans are telling you this. And you're just sitting there reading the bill, you're talking to CPAs, they go, no, this is going to be a tax. This is going to be a penalty. Nico had a joke this morning when I was ranting and raving about it. He goes, now, Alex, he goes, you know, it's not a penalty, it's a tax. And that's how they play these games. So now House Republicans warn against Obama administration's attempt to bail out Obamacare insurers, because the insurance companies wrote this, where the big ones get to make money on the front and on the end. Then it's meant to collapse healthcare. One of the authors of it on Fox News, Emanuel's brother, even admitted, oh, this is just step one. Once this wrecks the system, we're going to go to a single payer. They admit Cloward and Piven they're wrecking it on Fox. Here's another one. Insurance company sues for $223 million after Congress blocks Obamacare bailouts. And then here's what I was mentioning. 8.1 million taxpayers paid $1.7 billion in Obamacare penalties in 2014 alone. It's taken the feds a year and a half to release the numbers. That was the first year the penalty started kicking in 3 years ago. Can you imagine what they are? It's going to be the first year. It was 8.1 million people hit with $1.7 billion in tax penalties. But there is no penalty. Obama said so. And the lies. We've got Hillary with Lester Holt interrupting Trump 40 plus times, her seven, her giving hand signals. like it was a, you know, Three Stooges playing poker, whole following her every move, interrupting whenever she, I mean, it was, this whole, it's so rigged. I'm like asking myself, how much more rigged is this going to get? It's a lie of racist. The Obamacare is free. You can keep your doctor. There's no penalties. It says right here, 18,000 new IRS agents, $5,000 a year fines. No, it doesn't. Yeah, it's in the subsection. Shut up. Shut up, racist. And you got some crazy Nazi collaborator running around spending hundreds of millions of dollars to start race war. And I'm just like, how far does this go? How much crazier does it go? And then the UN's involved with George Soros. We have the emails trying to cause a civil war so they can then bring in some global government leftist truth commission reorganization of the United States. I mean, that's what I told you they'd do 10 years ago. Now it's all in the Washington Post today. And they're announcing babies being born with three parents. New Scientist. Just because we can. And designer humanoids and we have lost our moral compass. That's why this is happening. I'm going to come back and we've got, oh, by the way, we have a clip from 2003 of Trump saying he was against the Iraq war from Fox News. They say it doesn't exist. I found five clips of him saying it. But Lester Holt said it wasn't true. They think you don't remember that 3-4 years ago they were saying there is no penalty, there is no tax. But then it phases in, $1,000 the first year, $3,000 the next year, $5,000 the next. And there's actually language in there that if, quote, Obama wants to, because it gives the president a blank check and the next president, they can go in and maybe raise the tax even more. But we actually found some of the headlines, Associated Press, you name it, saying Matt Drudge is lying. There is no penalty. There is no tax. Let's put some of those on screen for TV viewers. Just to remind new listeners and listeners, that's TMP. Matt Drudge is probably lying, they added that, on paying huge Obamacare Liberty tax. Now, let's go back to another clip. We have tweets put out by the White House. Liberty tax, White House media attack after Drudge pays Obamacare opt-out penalty. And they go on to say, when this started 3 years ago, that it doesn't exist. Tell that to Darren McBreen. He says, I can talk about it. I want to get him to do a piece on it. One of our reporters has been here 5 years. Darren's been paying the penalty for 3 years, and it just went up this year to 5,000 juicies. 5,000 juicies for him. But it doesn't exist, and Matt Drudge is a liar. And, of course, Obama is calling for world government. So's the Pope. But that's a different world government than I was talking about all those years ago. Oh, but there's the headline, Obamacare penalty increasing sharply in 2016. And then I have all these mainstream articles here announcing that taxpayers in the first year of Obamacare paid $1.7 billion in penalties for not getting it. Oh, excuse me. And who implemented it? The Internal Revenue Service. That's what the bill said. It's what the bill did. And now you know why I get mad watching Lester Holt and Hillary Clinton. I mean, it was the biggest load of lies. I was short-circuiting. It was all lies, except for her saying, I'm going to extrajudicially just put you on list. You can't buy guns anymore. No more due process. Only thing she said that was true. A monstrous creature. And they say, we have no right to exist. The attorney general said 3 months ago, conservatives have no right to have media platforms. We need to censor them. She had to back off of that, but they are now moving forward. And Hillary put out an email 3 weeks ago in fundraising saying, we're going to shut down the alt media. And I remember thinking about who I named, Drudge and Breitbart, myself, and people got attacked by her. But she didn't attack Savage. And Savage was on 2 weeks ago saying, I'm really upset I wasn't named. He said some of that on air during the break. He goes, yeah, I'm upset she didn't name me. She named you. And I went, don't worry, buddy. They're even more scared of you. That's why they didn't name you. And you notice they took him off. And people are like, do you think it really happened? No, he was just telling me a week before that he might be kicked off the air sooner than it happened. Yeah, it happened. He's off the air. I guess I'll just be off the air and people will be, oh, well, or Alex just got shot in the street. No big deal, you know, or whatever happens. I'll just never commit suicide. Know that, folks. My head is spinning right now. Before I go any further, ladies and gentlemen, please support the broadcast, buy the products. They're excellent. InfoWarsLife.com. We have our new probiotic, 7 years in development. is being developed 2 years before I even got into business with Dr. Group. And it is amazing. It's got 50 billion live and active cultures, 23 different probiotic strains. We keep it refrigerated here. We ship it to you with an ice pack. And again, then it is very, very important to get it into the refrigerator to have it last. Last the longest and get the biggest effect. InfoWarsLife.com. Sign up for auto ship and get 10% off additional and so many other specials. Free shipping is extended, but only for one more day, and then it's over. There's some other specials as well. Stay with us. We'll be right back with hour two. Spread the word. It's an info war, and you are an active participant.
We are now 40 days from the November 8th, 2016 election. You're listening to the Alex Jones Show.
And we are now only 3 days out from the UN official takeover of the web.
GCN.
And the power to regulate is the power to destroy. And they say they're coming for us. Get ready. If you want to use the analogy of landing a passenger plane on the Hudson, went and saw Clint Eastwood's latest movie. It's pretty powerful. They always tell you, don't try to make it back to the airfield. That's when people crash. And I can tell you right now, we're not going to get America back to the airfield. And we're going to have a crash landing, but I hope it's going to be like the miracle on the Hudson, because we're dealing with organized crime worldwide that is in a consolidation phase to establish a planetary regime. And a few days ago, last week, we had the former head of the technical person that actually ran the National Security Agency, actually ran the spying. And I said, what are they building? And he said, a private corporate world government project. And the spy grid is a technocracy takeover of the planet. Now, that's my analysis, because that's his analysis, and that's reality. That's what it is. And they have scooped up every other tyrannical project and program that was out there, like the European Union project that was a Nazi living space, or Lebensraum, I think you say it in Deutsch, program. So it's not a Nazi conspiracy. It's just, it's got the British Empire cobbled into the Nazis, teamed up with the Muslims. It is a disastrous situation we're facing. And I look at the stack of news I covered in the last hour. Washington Post, New York Times, the UN's taking over. It's going to battle racism in America. It's going to run your police, and it's going to make sure there's reparations. Oh, the UN is going to have a carbon tax and give it to poor people. And then we actually got the carbon tax, which they wanted to be ratified 6 years ago in secret. And Lord Monckton got it. And they said, no, that's our document. You're right. Who got it? Oh, the Russians did. It was evil Russians, those pesky Russians, because they don't want to be under carbon taxes. Putin said it's a world government project to shut down Russia. Shut down any nation state. And then we got the document. It was right at double. One point under double the taxes on the third world that would be on the first world. The globalists hate the third world. They've kept their foot on their neck. They've kept them in squalor. They've put dictators in. They've sold, cultural division. They've financed military attacks by neighbors. Rebel armies. They promoted communism in Latin America and Africa as the way to counter the robber barons who literally created communism and bankrolled it and created the Soviet Union. It's all declassified. It's all confirmed. Joseph McCarthy knew it all. Russians 10 years ago released their files. It was worse than he said. Basically, everything he said was true, then it was 10 times worse. They just go, you're being mean to this little old black lady that's a custodian at the FBI. You're being mean to this little old white lady or this little old janitor. And it turned out, no, they were KGB agents. And they loved McCarthy when he was just helping set up a police state. Because after all, we were being invaded. We were being taken over. The Russians were killing millions of their own people, millions of Ukrainians, millions of Poles. They were horrible. The atrocities were terrible. They were persecuting Christians. We got to do something. He was war hero, World War II, tail gunner. Decorated highly, patriot. But when he discovered and came out and said, the U.S. Army, he had this from the Army because there were patriots in there, has been ordered to prop up the Russians and give them weapons and give them intel, and we're working with them. And they went, you went too far blaming our Army there, boy. That's preposterous. He said, yeah, there's all these big, rich, powerful people, and they're funny because they want to use it as a new form of tyranny, and you got to warn everybody. And he's like, oh, shut up, you old nut. And now here you are. It's not a communist conspiracy. It's a big mega bank conspiracy where they're tax exempt on 300-foot yachts with helicopters and jump jets and hundreds of mistresses and space stations they're building and all this other crap while they steal everything from us in a consolidated economy. It's amazing. We are 40 days out. I'm your host, Alex Jones. We're here Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Central Standard Time. I've got a bunch of really important video clips I want to play here in the next few minutes. Then I want to go to Dr. Group to talk about a host of issues. But I noticed a few days ago that the woman was preparing to give birth, and now she's given birth to a child that has the DNA of three people in it. And now they've got groups talking about, oh, two gay men want to have a child together, so they'll splice their DNA. And they're talking about, oh, we'll have maybe three women where it's, you know, this new right to do whatever you want. And as long as it's liberal, as long as it's trendy, it's okay. Well, I've actually interviewed a lot of genetic engineers and experts. One of them years ago was making millions of dollars a year in London, and he was creating a potato that basically lasted longer. But they found that when they fed it to mice, it caused mutations in the mice. But they said, we're going to go ahead and go forward with this. That's just one example. Do you know what happens if you splice the DNA of two men together, two mammals? I mean, I've done the research. They know for a fact what happens. And they're having to go in and basically turn off a bunch of other genes and then design this humanoid to be what they want, because it's not a human. When you cross two males together, what happens? There is a genetic line that is a complete other genetic DNA sequence that is only carried by women and is only transferred into the new human by a man and a woman. And they admit this, and they're saying, well, we'll choose the mitochondrial DNA line and we'll inject it. Folks, when they, going back 30, 40 years, would just take one GMO species and maybe change one trait, they would start getting really bad mutations. When you change 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 of them, things get really hairy. And by hairy, in every mammal species, when you just feed them GMO crops where they've put other organisms in it, you get genetic leakage of that DNA and even RNA and viruses that we could never get sick from, zoological viruses, zoological bacterium that don't really hurt humans. Those are now jumping species. And I could go on for hours. It's the top link on Drudge, one of the top stories on InfoWars as well. Baby with three parents, birth of a new era. We're going to be getting to that coming up. And they sell it in Time Magazine like, oh, it's this wonderful, wonderful, you know, happy, great thing. And it's just crazy how far all this has gone. And this is, worry about Rise of the Robots. What about, you think they put back doors in your iPhone? You think they put back doors in the chips? You think they manipulate things for social engineering? This is all about eugenics, all about control. And you've got such a sick, weird population. It's all into how they look. And so you can just imagine what people are going to want for their kids. I want my son to win all the basketball games. I want him to be 7 feet tall and have, you know, double Y or whatever. And just the power this gives the state to decide who can do this. The ramifications are just mind-blowing, mind-boggling. But don't worry, Monsanto buys the rights to CRISPR. And what's CRISPR? The U.S. agribusiness secures a global non-exclusive licensing agreement from the Broad Institute to use the gene editing technology for agricultural applications. I love how we pay for this, especially the eugenics base, Cold Springs Harbor. And then Monsanto, if any company is run by Satan, that's it. They say they're getting non-exclusive, but then they're going to make sub-patents on what they produce with it. And then they admit their plan is to have a patent on all life and not let any animal or plant on earth reproduce without going through their system. And of course, that is the big enchilada. They don't want you to be able to have children without it being artificially controlled. That's why they admitted the goal 30 years ago was to have basically all births by 2025 be cesarean. They're already up to 60% in Austin, Texas, which leads the country last time I read in cesareans. And they've got a scam they run. I mean, folks, it's on. Okay? It's on. You think, well, the average nurse or doctor's not part of it. No, they just follow the guidelines of their guild, or they get removed. And if they tell them they want 100% cesarean, they're going to do it. And I'm telling you, you'll get to the point where people will say, in the past, we were grown in our mothers. Mothers. Mother is a sexist term. Not allowed. No, you think I'm joking? I'd say this 10 years ago. Now they're saying mother and father is sexist. Mother and father is evil. Don't have it on entrance papers. Don't, because someone may not have a mother and father. How did I know that years before they started doing it? Because they said their goal is an asexual, 4-foot-tall creature. If they even want those around, that goes around servicing things for them. And then the ruling elite, which are a new species, this is admitted, will basically rule over the suboids that look like dwarf clowns. And I don't know, that's their plan. It's been in mainstream news. I remember reading about it from H.G. Wells. Of course, Aldous Huxley, he wrote about it in 1932, Brave New World, and he gave a speech before he died in 62 at Berkeley, saying, this isn't a joke. I'm from an elite family, a secret breeding program, and this is our real plan. And it's the real plan. So you want to be a 3.5-4 foot tall, you know, drilling clown creature. And you're like, that's not going to happen. Look at everything they do. They want abominations. They want to make humans fall. The elite do. They, who are hunchback goblins themselves. I mean, look at Madeleine Albright. Look at Hillary Clinton. They rise up to be the big 6'5" beautiful person. You become the goblin creature. And by the way, they'll make fun of this in national news. I know they will. Google elite believers splitting into two species. And then it shows, and click web, because it'll be older articles, and this is their plan. The Morlocks don't like the Eloi. So we're going to get to Dr. Group in a moment with that information and get his take on all this. But before we do, there are a bunch of these clips. He wrote about it in the book in 2004, but I remember 2003, Trump being criticized for saying, I don't know if this is a good idea. Now, we've dug around. Stuff back then is harder to find. But we did find one from right as the invasion was about to happen, saying he doesn't know if it's a good idea, doesn't think it is. This is him calling into Fox News. Now, remember, Lester Holt, when he said, you know, Lester Holt said, you were not, because he's God. He's the fact checker. Hell, he ought to be president. He's the guy with the earpiece in his ear. He's the one getting the signals from Hillary. You know, like it's baseball. It was really, really bad. So that went on and on. And then we ought to find the clip of this and put it together. And then Trump's like, yeah, I was against it. No, you were not. I'm Lester Holt. I'm God. No, you were not. I'm Lester Holt. I speak with authority. Obamacare is free. There are no penalties. Associated Press. Americans paid how many billion? $1.7 billion in the first year of Obamacare in penalties, the IRS. The UN isn't going to take over. Washington Post, UN to run our police. U.S. should pay reparations to black people. When the UN's mowing blacks down as we speak all over Africa. I mean, this is crazy. But let's go to Donald J. Trump. Here it is.
I had to sort of break down for the president. If you were advising him how much time you commit to Iraq versus how much time you commit to the economy, what would you say?
Well, I'm starting to think that people are much more focused now on the economy. They're getting a little bit tired of hearing we're going in, we're not going in. Whatever happened to the days of Douglas MacArthur? I mean, he'd go and attack. He wouldn't talk. I mean, we have to, you know, it's sort of like either do it or don't do it.
You're saying the leash on this is getting kind of short here, that the president has got to do something, presumably sooner rather than later, and stringing this along could ultimately hurt us.
Well, he's either got to do something or not do something.
Yeah.
Perhaps. Because perhaps he shouldn't be doing it yet. And perhaps we should be waiting for the United Nations. He's under a lot of pressure. I think he's doing a very good job. But, of course, if you look at the polls, a lot of people are getting a little tired. I think the Iraqi situation is a problem, and I think the economy is a much bigger problem.
Which is what he always said. Focus on the economy. Don't start wars that now have cost us $6 trillion. Now, I'm going to skip this break so we have more time. We're going to Dr. Group here in just a moment to get into all this breaking medical news. But before I go any further, let's play some more clips. This is some of the people that work for Obama making jokes basically about the American people Let's play that clip.
The point is that you have equal impact on serious speeches because it's about style, use of language, etc.
The joke speech is the most fun part of this, but the things I'm the most proud of were the more serious speeches, I think. Healthcare, economic speeches, and I think...
Lovett wrote the line about, if you like your insurance, you can keep it.
How dare you?
Huge impact.
And you know what? It's still true.
Yeah, and we have Gruber laughing about, thank God the American people have no attention span, they're dumb. With all the professors, yeah, we feed on them. And then we've got the head of the State Department spokesperson going, oh God, we lie to everyone, it's so funny. Oh, it's so good. And then if they don't like it, we just call them racist. And if they don't like that, we just shut Michael Savage off the radio. And now they're openly saying they want to shut us down. Hillary puts out a fundraiser saying, shut down the alt-right. Let's ban the word mother and father. Ha, ha, ha. It's so much fun. Now, let's go to Dr. Group, again, the Global Healing Center, a patriot, veteran, great guy, helped us develop many of the nutraceuticals we have at InfoWarsLife.com. I wanted to get him on a host of issues today. By the way, we were conspiracy theorists again. National News attacked me a few years ago, saying that I claimed with no evidence that leprosy was coming back in the U.S., but you could go to the CDC and see the numbers were 10 times more what they were in many states than they were ever in our modern history. And I told you I talked to health department folks about all the leprosy they're dealing with in Florida and in Texas and in California. Wet leprosy, the type that spreads, and TB's exploding everywhere. But that Obama doesn't even do medical checks at the border. We've actually interviewed the Border Patrol Union at the Texas border saying black plague, syphilis, drug-resistant TB, everything's coming across. And so now it's been confirmed, all those cases of leprosy in the California schools, it's been confirmed. Let's put that on screen for TV viewers, for radio listeners. I'll read it to you. International Business Times, leprosy cases confirmed in Southern California elementary school. And there is no cure. But they can stop the spread so your daughter's nose and everything doesn't rot off too quickly with super strong antibiotics. And I've got articles here about flesh-eating bacteria. Multi 20,000 plus percent increases, just mass death all over the place. But when you get eaten to death by that, which literally 30, 40, 50 times, depending on what state you're in, chance of being killed by flesh-eating bacteria, they call it an infection, non-treatable infection, then buy a gun, but it's okay. Don't worry. Everything's fine. The Hollywood Reporter says the elite are buying bunkers and fleeing to New Zealand. You're like, I heard that before. Of course you did. Heard it here. But now it's all coming out. So, Dr. Group, thank you so much for joining us. Be with us for the balance of the hour. So much to get into, so much to cover. I got to tell you, I keep saying this, but every day it becomes more real. Everything we've warned about, everything we've talked about that we knew was already true, we have the documentation for, is now out in the open. You were writing 10 years ago, first person I saw doing it, about studies out there that if you don't have good flora in your gut, it's linked to cancer and autoimmune disorders. That was even in the New York Times and Wall Street Journal a few months ago. They said, wow, the gut, having bad gut flora may be the leading cause of cancer and the leading cause of autoimmune disorders. Oh, wow, look at that. I mean, they knew all along. Bill and Melinda Gates are spending billions a year just studying gut flora. They know exactly what they're doing with the Monsanto, BT corn, the rest of it. I mean, this is a diabolical plan. They admit it's a diabolical plan. And here we are in the middle of it. But what happens is our credibility explodes, as your credibility explodes, as theirs implodes, and as they figure that out, that we're bigger. InfoWars is way bigger than CNN. We're just one little outlet of liberty. What are they going to do as they panic and realize some young conservative woman can have 63 million views per video? What happens is they realize that they are the ones that are the emperor wearing no clothes?
Well, I mean, we have been talking about that for a long time. And I think back to close to 20 years ago when I devoted my life to finding the root cause of all disease. And if you kind of think of it in a way like they have an army, the globalists, and their army is a combination of genetically modified foods, fluoride in the water, chlorine, and the list goes on and on and on, and the million difference of toxins that they expose us to on a regular basis. And by the way, this is all planned. And then we have an army. The thing is, they know what our army is. most of us don't know what their army is. So we have an army of gut microbiome, and that's our army. I mean, it's now been proven, and I wrote a book probably 15 years ago called Health Begins in the Colon. And disease also begins in the colon, in the intestinal tract, because we have this massive 3 pounds of good probiotic, good flora that's supposed to protect us. That's our army. How are we going to fight an army of 1 million chemicals and toxins coming into our system that are specifically designed to kill off our army? It'd be like their army has laser guns and machine guns, and our army has butter knives. It just doesn't work. So that's why for all these years I've been promoting gut health, gut health, gut health. The thing is, over our lifetime, we only have 2 exposure points. We have 2 ways to get probiotics in our system. The first one, which you were talking about with the C-sections and all the medical promotions of don't breastfeed.
No, wait, don't engage in conspiracy theory. Women, saying the word woman is a gender term and is hurtful. So that gender doesn't exist, okay, first. And breastfeeding never existed. And vaginal birth never existed. So stop being a conspiracy theorist.
Well, what I'm saying is we only have 2 ways to get probiotics. One, from breast milk. And that's the most important thing we can do to set the stage for health in our body. The second is through eating foods that we consume. Now, we've gotten away and we've gone to man-made foods, and that was instituted on purpose as well. Now some people are eating organic foods, which is great, but that's the only way that we're going to get probiotics. All these people out here talk about eating yogurt, but think about it. You make yogurt with pasteurized milk, okay? It's chemical ridden in there with artificial sweeteners and everything else. But probiotics are actually bacteria that live all over the body that people just think they're in the intestinal lining, but they're not. They're on your skin. Good probiotics are on your skin. That's why using all these antibacterial soaps and all
this stuff. I learned when I was a teenager that after football practice, if I scrub my face with soap, even the fancy ones that were more organic, that's when I would get zits and break out. But if I just use light shampoo, clean under my arms and stuff, but didn't take the oil off my face, I didn't have zits and all the other young people did.
Right. So everything by design is designed to kill off not only the probiotics in your gut, but the vaginal
probiotics. Here's an example. Last week I had a pen burst while I was on air. We had to go to tape for about 5 minutes. It burst in my hand. I rubbed my face, not seeing it. I had black all over the side of my nose, down my face here. I had to go in the bathroom, get soap, wash it off. I never washed my face with soap. And boom. I got huge zits that I hadn't had since I was like 13 years old, all down where the ink was, because I guess the ink was toxic, but also the soap to scrub it off, because it took a lot of it, again, killed my good bacteria.
So that's another reason why we have such a problem with antibacterials these days, is because our good bacteria is being affected by it as well. And you have probiotics in the urinary tract, you have them in the respiratory system that are being killed off by all the chemicals in the air. So it really is an attack on our probiotics or our good microorganisms or our army that's there to protect us. The collection of probiotics concentrated in the gut, like we were talking about earlier, is called the microbiome. And believe it or not, it actually has 20 times more genetic material than we do. And it's like a fingerprint. It's each person's identification. It's different on each individual person. And the probiotics that we have in our body outnumber our cells 10 to 1. So picture that. You have 10 times as many.
And so we eat pesticide-laden food, fluoride, garbage, bad bacteria, GMO bacteria, all the different herbicides that are bioaccumulated in the foods. And I've been reading studies that some people that are 60, 70, 80 basically have nothing in their gut. It's just dead, or it's full of all these bad yeast, which, again, we showed mainstream news earlier, Scientific American and others. Mental health may depend on creatures in the gut. Even the New York Times was admitting major studies, massive cancer linked to not having good probiotics in the gut. And that's why I'm going to go ahead and plug right now, because I want to get into genetically engineered babies after the break. We have a new probiotic, 7 years in the making by Dr. Group. I kept going to him and saying, which of these companies should I use? There's hundreds of great probiotics. And he said, I'm waiting with these top firms to to get the very best strains and put out the best. So I waited. He's brought it out for us. Probiotic, biome defense, 50 billion live and active cultures. Dr. Group, talk about this. It's available at InfoWarsLife.com. At the factory, it's made in the cold. It's kept in a big refrigeration system here. It's shipped to you with an ice pack. Now, if it gets warm, it still keeps a lot of its activeness, but you want to keep it cool for maximum effect. Put it in your refrigerator. Take it daily. We're showing people video on PrisonPlanet.tv and folks watching the live streams of our cold room. And this is, again, the Rolls Royce at a cost almost half of what leading competitors are for something of this quality. Describe why this is so special.
The reason why it took me so long to develop this product is because I wanted to really get a lot of research done on what are the best strains to put in the body. Once I found that, I started contacting the probiotic culturing companies. There's about four big companies, and those are the companies that every single probiotic supplement on the market uses to culture them. So when I went to these companies originally and I said, how do you make these probiotics? I want a vegetarian, vegan-based probiotic. I want non-GMO. I don't want any of these toxic fillers and excipients, because most of the capsules, all these probiotics you see in the grocery store or the vitamin shops or anything, there's only probably 10 or 15 milligrams, and these capsules hold 750 milligrams. Most of them only contain about 15 or 20 milligrams of the actual probiotic itself. The other part of the capsule is nothing but filler. And so when I contacted all these companies and asked them, well, what are you using?
Let's break it down, because this is important, folks. I mean, we guarantee we work the hardest to bring you what we personally are using. This is what my children take, what I take. It's so incredibly important, and it funds the operation. It's a 360 win. Stay with us. We'll be back with this, the designer babies, and more. I'm going to talk about this CRISPR system. I've mentioned it some, but basically it's a computerized live system. It's very inexpensive now. It can be deployed all over the world to go in and cut out pieces of DNA that you want to replace, whether it's for having spiritual connections, having a higher consciousness that's been proven to be in the DNA, to have a proclivity to be angry, to want to oppose illegitimate authority. Clearly, this will be for social engineering. But they're saying, oh, we'll cut out the cancer genes. We'll cut out the depression genes, just like they've got vaccines they're, quote, already developed that will end mental illness, or will end paranoia, or will end stress. And then you read, it's a virus that goes in and literally eats certain areas of neuroreceptors that are also associated with enlightenment, spiritual feelings, those highs and those lows, your conscience. So they're trying to dehumanize us. We'll talk about that in a few minutes. And again, this isn't science fiction. I've told the story many times of about 14 and a half years ago, going in to pick up a pizza to take it home to the family. My wife then was pregnant with a son, and a guy going, hey, you're lying about spiders being crossed with goats. I heard you on the radio, and I used to like you. You're a liar. And I went, let me guess, you go to biology, you know, 20 years ago? And he goes, I went to UT in 1973. That's right. How did you know that? And I went, well, I've run into this before. I said, it's in the news that they've got goats that are part spider that create body armor out of their milk. I'm not lying. He started going, man. And I was like, dude, let's just get out of my face. And I told that story that night I was on the radio. Back then, I was still on the radio at night as well. Well, that had been in 100 newspapers then. Now it's been in thousands. There it is on screen, the goats with spider genes and silk in their milk. But they count on the public being ignorant. They count on the public not understanding what's going on. We're light years ahead of this, ladies and gentlemen. We're light years ahead of this. And you talk about humanity getting Promethean fire, or that Atlantean moment when we get something so high tech, it's beyond us and it, you know, basically destroys our civilization. We're here. The Genesis engine. We now have the power to quickly and easily alter DNA. It could eliminate diseases. It could solve world hunger. It could provide unlimited clean energy. It could really get out of hand. By Amy Waxman. It's already gotten out of hand. Ladies and gentlemen, they have declassified that they had humanoid clones 35 years ago. And now they're announcing they're going to start rolling them out for you. You're not going to see all the mistakes, the mutations, the creatures that should have rights but didn't, because they weren't animal, they weren't human. They were in the phantom zone. Dr. Group is our guest. I really appreciate him joining us and going over this. But speaking of protecting your gut, we promote things that we know you need, like gravity-fed water filtration systems that reduce or completely cut out hundreds and hundreds of different chemicals. Some things they totally cut out. Some things it's like 99.999. You don't want to drink glyphosate. You don't want to drink fluoride. You don't want to drink, you know, the bisphenol A. I could go on for hours with the stuff. The average water supply has over 300 different contaminants in it. Well water, you name it. We sell the Alexa Pure, the Pro Pure. They're all great systems that basically cut everything out or bring it down to almost non-detectable levels. And it funds our operation. Same thing with Biome Defense Probiotics, 60 vegetarian capsules. He was getting into how the others are basically fillers and or are lazily just a few basic strains. Group, the reason I went with Group is he was known by the different supplement and health Nazi sites, and I mean that in a Seinfeld way, by the real connoisseurs, the real, you know, the real cutting-edge people as the guy that doesn't cut corners. And I want to have great products, but also I don't want the FDA to be able to come after me. I want to be able to follow all the rules of the very safest, most tested stuff. And so, and I've used two other big companies as well that are also known for being great, but Group does about half our products. And he also advises us on the others. And sometimes he can't put something out just because his standards are so high. And I go, you know what? We're going to be a half inch lower than you. And I've got to put this out. This is important. You know, and so some of the stuff we put out, he's like, yeah, it's overall really good. But I'd put that out if we could actually find a clean source of this. And I'm just like, clean? Your stuff's cleaner than the air, man. I'm just being honest about Group. That's how good he is. He's over there smiling. You know, we've had these arguments, believe me. So the point is, I kept saying, like a year ago, I go, I'm going to come out with a probiotic I can private label that's good. This is a huge market. I'm already taking probiotics. I'm sure yours is going to be the best, but I really want a probiotic. He finally did it. Biome Defense, why is this the best? You were getting into the fact that it doesn't have all this garbage filler in it, and why it's such a game changer at InfoWarsLife.com.
Right. So it's an interesting story because it took such a long time to try to convince. First of all, three of the big companies that produced the probiotics basically laughed in my face and hung up the phone. I had to convince one of them was actually interested in listening to me. And I actually talked to their main scientist. And after months of collaboration, I'm telling him that I want the strongest probiotic out there. I want these unique strains in it. I want it cultured in vegetarian, vegan. I don't want it cultured in gelatin from cows from slaughterhouses. They basically had to change their whole procedure. I had to guarantee them that I was going to purchase enough so they could actually do the R&D.
And again, you don't want to grow this in gelatin that's bone and cartilage material because that's where the prion type garbage is. And that's why neurological disorders. I mean, I know so many people who have 30, 40-year-old members of their family that are now having, quote, Parkinson's. And it's because, let's just be honest about it, mad cow type spectrum garbage is everywhere, people. Go ahead.
Well, yeah, and you have most people have no clue how probiotics are made or how they're cultured. And I got deep into the research and development on this. They basically thought I was crazy. The president of the company got on the phone with me and they said, do you understand what you're doing? You're like changing this whole field. And I said, this is the way the field's going to go anyway. Either you're with me or you're without me. I'll find a way to do it anyway. So finally, we had to go through probably a couple years of research and development.
And by the way, let's toot your horn, but you also have been going to Germany and going to France and going to other places. This is where it's already going in the high-tech clinics. You get it by prescription. It's already basically gone to what we're doing, but to the general public. And I even forgot that. I mean, the reality of this is 10 times cooler than I'm even saying. I mean, when we say 7 years, you've been doing this for 2 years before you were working with us. I mean, you've finally done it. Go ahead.
Yes, exactly. And it's still to this day, we are the only ones in the world right now that have this unique technique. I mean, they also say, are you crazy? This thing's going to be so expensive. No one's ever asked for this quality and this many strains in one probiotic formula before. So long story short, we actually got it done. We got it done using certified organic ingredients. All the other probiotics out there are filled with silicon dioxide, GMO, by the way, maltodextrin. And now we have proof that genetically modified foods actually change the flora in your gut to produce glyphosate. Well, what is glyphosate? Glyphosate is a pesticide. What do pesticides do? They kill off organisms. They kill off bacteria. So it's a revolving cycle, a revolving door. We chose stuff like Bifidobacterium lactis, which has the ability to protect your cells and your digestive tract against...
Well, look at how Bill and Melinda Gates and the Rockefeller Foundation are behind Zika. That's admitted, patented it. They're in the treatment of it. They're obsessed with gut flora. They're heavily involved with Monsanto. Of course they're going to roll out a GMO products that then grow weed killer in our guts, that then grows cancers, because they see us as weeds.
By the way, Alex, we recommend that you keep the probiotics refrigerated, but the majority of probiotics in this formula are actually the way that we coat them with the certified organic gum acacia and the inulin in there. We actually give you food for the probiotics as well. So there's actually fulvic acid, which contains all the necessary minerals and nutrients the probiotics need to survive. We put the inulin in there, which is a natural food for probiotics, the gum acacia. So it's a probiotic, prebiotic formula as well.
In fact, let's stop. You take 5 minutes and I'm going to get into the designer babies because I've been interrupting with my excitement. Explain to people the 7 years of research, taking from research in Europe, adding to it, testing, years of you know, producing, making it better and better. Why this is so different, why it's going to change the entire industry. And by the way, folks, 5 years ago, nobody was talking about true nascent iodine, not the alcohol-based garbage, not the stuff that you can't absorb that's toxic, but true, pure, good halogen. Now you go to Whole Foods, it's everywhere, but it's still the garbage type. I mean, that's how lazy these companies are, or I guess they're not as blessed as we are, but we've changed the whole industry. When we say this will change probiotics, this will change it. You will in a few years. Everyone will be copying this because this is the best probiotic out there, bar none. You can go to medical clinics and get it for $400, maybe get something as good in Europe. So Dr. Group, break it down why it's such a game changer, Biome Defense.
It's such a game changer because 70% of your immune system is actually in your digestive tract. It's now been proven that 90% of all autoimmune diseases, which are running rampant, are gut-related. 9 out of 10 people with autism have probiotic imbalances. All the digestive disorders, leaky gut, constipation, Crohn's, it doesn't matter what it is, are all linked to probiotics. 70 million people suffer from digestive disorders. Dr. Alan Walker at Harvard, actually, that's where I am right now, he's a world-renowned doctor and probiotic specialist. He actually, quote, said probiotics turn on the immune system and prevent pathogens from taking hold. So we have the immune link. We also have a lot of neuroscience research coming out, which we've been saying for years. Your brain is in your gut. I mean, all the prescriptions that people are given, especially the antidepressants, the anti-anxieties, all those affect your normal gut. Think about this. Think about if you have all the natural probiotics you need in your gut, how many antibiotics and prescription medications that people can get off of and come back to their normal state of living. And they're doing it with just putting the proper types of microorganisms.
I was about to tell the average medical doctor after you take antibiotics won't tell you it kills all your gut flora. You've got to take probiotic. They don't even tell people.
Listen, I mean, well, a scary thought is they just did a study not too long ago, and they found 34% of organic food contains traces of antibiotics. We have antibiotic residue in the water supply. We have antibiotic residue everywhere. So regardless, there's no ifs, ands, and buts about it. We have to focus on our own internal army. We have to take probiotics on a daily basis. I mean, and that's why I spent 7 years trying to figure out which ones are the best, how to do it, which ones are going to work in unison. And most of them in the formula, we haven't had time to do the long-term studies to see if we really are losing a lot of activity by not keeping it refrigerated. But I can say 90% of the ones in there we already know are heat resistant, acid resistant.
Sure, but we still keep it cold, which is an added expense, but again, it's important. Exactly. Now, I was interrupting you. Run through how this is a different proprietary process, but you did take known, proven, super high quality strains. You just boosted it, giving them the enzymes, the food they need to launch and actually survive the stomach.
We gave them everything that they're going to need to be able to survive and thrive. I mean, health begins in the gut and disease also begins in the gut. And so by, you know, you're obviously going to be attacked every single day. I mean, the gut is the first line of defense that we have in our body. And especially with all the biological weapons, with all the chemical agents, everything else that's attacking us every single day, we need to make sure that we keep our gut healthy. That's why I chose the specific 23 different strains of probiotics and biome defense. We have a special form of Lactobacillus acidophilus, which produces vitamin K. Why do you think so many people are deficient in vitamin K in the world? Why do you think so many people are deficient in magnesium, calcium, copper, selenium, all of those things? The probiotics in your gut have a vital role in the absorption of some of the most sought after and needed minerals and vitamins in your body. We put the Lactobacillus brevis in there. Why do we do that? Because we know that people are short on interferon. Interferon's a protein which is produced in response to viruses, bad bacteria, tumors, harmful organisms. So that's going to help your body naturally produce the interferon in there.
And by the way, I remember you saying this 6, 7, 8 years ago, that asthma's epidemic, much of it is because we don't have the right gut flora. And I was like, where's he coming from with that? Now they have a big study out, the Wall Street Journal, reporting on just that.
Yeah, asthma, allergies, leaky gut syndrome, all of these molecules. Probiotics, we didn't even talk about their role in digestion. Probiotics have an extremely powerful role in digestion. They help you digest your food. Not only is it the digestive enzymes, but also it's the probiotics. We put another probiotic in there that's missing, we found in the majority of the population. That's called Lactobacillus gisseri. And that's used to keep your weight regulated. What we found is the majority of people don't have that. And when you do put that strain of probiotic, it initiates. And these are all proven with clinical trials.
And they've got big clinical trials, as you said. Low gut flora, specifically that strain, you just keep eating and eating and eating, gaining weight, just like we knew 20 years ago. Aspartame makes you want to eat more and makes you fatter. That's why you see the biggest, fattest people are obsessed with diet drinks. And finally, mainstream media 2 years ago admitted diet drinks headline make you fat, but specifically aspartame, because it's a plan. They know what they're doing. And if you read deeply, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation are the ones quarterbacking this operation, Dr. Group.
Yeah, talking about sugar, sugar is one of the most damaging things to the gut flora, especially the white processed sugar. But this one strain that we have, this gisseri, is actually used and been studied to promote weight loss. It helps reduce body fat. It inhibits fat production. It speeds up the metabolism. It protects against obesity.
Bottom line, cows have three stomachs. They would die without the bacteria that break the grass down. We have bacteria and other flora. We must have them. Incredible. Now, how does this work with taking the parasite cleanse that you developed for us, the Living Defense? Because that's the big sleeper product that people just say they get the most amazing results with.
Well, it works with anything. I tell you, most of these probiotics that we chose have actually been used in combination with antibiotics. And the studies show that, you know, we think, yes, antibiotics will wipe out all the good bacteria. Every single doctor out there should be putting their patients on a probiotic at the same time as they're on antibiotics.
But the bacteria associated with the production of farming and ranching and pig farming and chicken farming and poultry farming, those are all resistant because they feed them that stuff because it makes them bloat and get fat. People ask, why do these big chicken production facilities, and by the way, I've worked in it, folks, just on the edge of it, but I've been involved cleaning them out, a job I had. It's hellish. You have to wear a breather mask and everything. It's because it makes them fat and obese. It makes the chickens and the pigs fat and obese. That's why they put it in their feed, but then it makes the bacteria that are in them totally resistant. Now you wonder why there's all the flesh-eating bacteria, but then you eat those animals, you get big dosages of it, so all you've got is the bad antibiotic-resistant that are in the gut, which Bill and Melinda Gates and others are on record designing in many cases, specifically in the food chain, to hit you with a soft kill weapon developed at Cold Springs Harbor by his father in Army Intelligence. We'll be back. Stay with us. Alex Jones here, back live. This is just now being proposed. Bayer and Monsanto merging, two of the biggest corporations in the world. And when I said there's probably no company more evil than Monsanto, Agent Orange, Dioxin, Terminator Genes, BT Corn, I mean, they consistently do bad things. Aspartame, we were just talking about, that eats your brain, makes you obese, on record. Monsanto has a close second in Bayer, the Nazi pharmaceutical company, the company that knowingly shipped out Factor VIII to hundreds of thousands of hemophiliacs in the 90s. And it came out in federal court in Australia and France that the CEOs were told, sir, you understand this is going to kill people. Everyone we give this to, it has hepatitis and HIV. And they're like, I don't care. Too many hemophiliacs anyways. Man, you talk about evil. That's who they put in charge of these things. And that's what they say in corporate board meetings. Imagine sitting around a corporate board meeting. If we ship this out, hundreds of thousands will die. Yeah, well, the world needs ditch diggers too. You know, I've sent boys younger than you to the gas chamber. Didn't want to do it. Felt I owed it to them. I mean, where do these people come from? That's what I'm telling you. Guys, I've watched the PBS things that nobody else takes the time to go watch, where Bill Gates sits there and talks about his dad heading Planned Parenthood, and his dad, we went and researched him, super spooky eugenics guy, involved in the whole clandestine program, secret testing. That's why IBM, that's a eugenics front company that created Microsoft, that's all super secret, by the way, folks, is running this show. Okay, and they ran the Hollerith machines, they ran the death camps. They ran the death camps. IBM technicians from the U.S. were in each death camp. The numbers on the folks in the death camps were IBM Hollerith numbers, okay? I mean, you don't get more evil than International Business Machines, okay? It's a eugenics company. Thomas Watson received the highest award that anyone in the Nazi regime awarded, above Adolf Hitler, who got the second highest award. The number one award the Nazis ever gave went to the creator of IBM. Now, that's all you got to know right there. That's why I get chills. That's why I'm cutting over group, because while he's talking, if you're a TV viewer, they're just in there Googling what he says, everything he says, even mainstream news. That's what's crazy. It's all admitted, folks, but all admitted in the last year or two. So, Dr. Group, I want to get into CRISPR in the next segment, and I know you got to go, but which is even bigger. But why do you think it's suddenly all coming out? I mean, isn't that kind of positive, WikiLeaks and all this info? I mean, isn't it that people, even in the establishment, love their kids, and there's only a few evil people on top trying to keep us in the dark? I mean, that's why what you're doing, what others are doing, what we're doing, you know, funding ourselves to put out the truth and give people things to counter this. I mean, it's just, it's a perfect symbiotic thing. But do you think we're starting to turn the tide, or what do you think's happening?
When you start seeing the pharmaceutical companies and the big companies starting getting into the probiotics and trying to acquire all the natural health companies, you'd be amazed at how many natural health companies you see on the shelves at Whole Foods that are actually owned by big conglomerates or private equity firms. They've been knocking on our door. It's crazy what's going on out there.
They've tried to buy us. We've had, you know, I had to sign a non-disclosure, obviously, but we've had some of the biggest cosmetic companies try to buy us.
But at the same time, they're ramping up all their artificial intelligence. They're ramping up the vaccines. They're ramping up all the chemicals. You know, look at Bayer and Monsanto, like what you're talking about. You know, you really have, you know, I always say we the people, because, you know, the people can create change in the world faster than the politicians can. Look at all the good thing with the internet, good thing with your radio show, all the things that we've been able to get out there to people so that they can help make.
And that's why they're so scared. They know if we wake up and just change our behavior, it's game over. That's why they want to get us into a fully artificial economy they control, because then there's hardly any way to get out. Stay there. We're going to come right back in 70 seconds to give you the floor on this. And then, but you got to come to town. This is an on-fire subject, Dr. Group. I know you're at Harvard right now with top researchers. I mean, how cool is that? I'm like, where are you? I'm at Harvard to meet with him on the probiotic. I mean, this guy knows what he's doing. I mean, we're not playing games here. And I'm so blessed to have him working with us. Ladies and gentlemen, you know, I sit up here and I cover this stuff. And a lot of times we'll be far off from something and I make a prediction because of all the different data points I've got. And it's usually pretty darn on target. But let me tell you, it's not a good feeling to now have them openly announcing world government, openly announcing the UN is going to run race relations in the U.S. and our local police departments. That's in the Washington Post. But at the same time, I guess it's good news, because our credibility is going to go up. It is going up. People are really listening now. Hillary's having to counter us. But then we know what the next shoe to drop is. They're going to shut us down. And they just shut down Michael Savage. He told me the week before they were trying to censor him at CBS. We're 2 days into him being off the air, and people are not even making a big deal out of it. Because, again, we're Americans. This can't happen here. I think we have to admit it did happen here, Dr. Group.
You know, you were talking earlier, you know, are we making progress? Are we getting the information out? And I say yes. And I really think that we are at a tipping point, and they are starting to realize that. And they know that there's so many people going online. There's so many people out there that are outspoken now. Their lies are being, you know, discovered. They're being open. Everybody's starting to realize it. So the next step, I mean, obviously, get the UN involved. You can blame it on the UN. That way it doesn't have anything to do with the U.S. government. And it really is kind of scary thinking about what's going to happen here in the next couple years, what direction we're going to go. Think about it. I mean, what happens if they shut the internet down? I mean, that's going to completely restrict access to people getting everything they need to protect themselves. It's going
And who takes the UN over in 3 days? I mean, who takes the internet over in 3 days?
Yeah. I mean, another thing that's looking around, and one of the hot topics right now that we're getting at our office is just like, how many people do you know that are happy? I mean, you have the so much controversy going on with the elections. You have people that are just under so much stress these days. And by the way, stress is another big factor.
I know liberals, fake liberals that have always been friendly to me, that now are mad at me and won't talk to me when I see them. And I'm like, hey, I forgive you for being a gun-grabbing idiot. Why do you have to hate me now? And they're so unhappy.
It's like spreading in a way. And I think that, you know, back to the gut issue, how important it is, because 90% of the serotonin is produced in your gut.
And they admit anxiety, depression, it's all record high.
You have more nerves. Think about the brain. Think about how many nerve pathways you have in the brain. You have more in your stomach and digestive tract than you do in your brain. Your appendix, which I've said for a long time, is one of the most important things. It's really your microcomputer system of your whole body. Your appendix is your brain. It actually squirts out probiotics when you need it.
Yes.
It's the Russians and the Germans linked the appendix to controlling every system in your body, the endocrine, the neurological system. And what do? We cut it out. But one of the good things about people really repairing and getting that gut, that those 3 pounds is what you're supposed to have of good bacteria, which, by the way, weighs as much as your brain. Your brain weighs 3 pounds, so go figure on that one. But when you do have
the bacteria are part of a high-tech electrochemical sensor system interfacing with our brain. The gut is hooked into the spinal cord and is just the bottom of the brain.
Yeah, the gastrointestinal tract actually has a nerve running straight to the brain. It's called the vagus nerve.
Exactly. No, it's perfect sense. The brain runs the whole show, and it's down there, you know, it's enjoying the food itself. I mean, it's just the brain. The gut is the brain.
The gut is actually the brain, and the gut actually controls everything. And that's the biggest secret that the medical profession hopes you never find out.
Well, folks, right, go with there. The gut. We've got the new probiotic, 7 years in the making. Biome Defense, game changer. I cannot hype how awesome it is. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. Dr. Group, please come here and shoot some specials when you're done with meeting with the Harvard researchers to go over all this, to really break down how amazing this is. Thank you so much. You're a godsend. We'll be back. Stay with us. All right, folks, it's the countdown. Only 40 days out. Now, until about 40 after, speak of the devil, we've got Steven Crowder, who my son's a big fan of, but a lot of folks my age are as well. Hell, I'm not that old at 42. I've been watching him for years since he was a TV star on national television. But I'm going to go over his whole background. Comedian, radio host, conservative, and author of LouderWithCrowder.com, reaching millions and millions of people every single week. Just all part of the burgeoning, independent, true liberal. I mean, I think we're classically liberal. Lower taxes, right to self-defense, private property, practice your religion or don't. The opposite of the modern fascistic liberals. But this guy's also hilarious. I want to play a clip of him imitating Shinker, Unker, Tunker, or whatever his name is, from the Young Turks when they invited me up on the stage, folks, at Radio Row. It was all packed in there. And then they blew up once I got up there. I don't think he knew they invited me. It was a setup. He went completely crazy. They spit on me. They called me fat. When you put photos of me, I mean, I got a big head, but I'm not that fat anymore. I guess I'm husky. I guess kind of like Steven, but he's in better shape than I am. And they just totally went crazy. And so I'm not going to play the whole skit. They're on Louder with Crowder.com. He's the guy that famously dressed up and went into one of the fitness places, you know, saying he was transgender, but they kicked him out. He really illustrates their absurdity quite well, and they hate him. So let's play a few minutes of him playing the part of the head young turd.
I agree with you, Cenk. So f***ing much.
That's absolutely right. When you use the F word, you know it's real talk.
I said f***.
So we have a bunch of people who wanted to make phone calls to the show because we wanted to have a discussion. So let's have the first caller.
Hi, Cenk. Paul Joseph Watson here, first-time caller. I'd really like to get your clarification on the Armenian genocide, specifically if you accept the historical fact that it happened.
Okay, all right, I understand, because that's bullshit! Get the fuck off the phone! That's racist! You're racist! Get the fuck out! Get the fuck out!
I don't know why you're yelling. It's a simple...
Get the fuck out! Get off the phone!
Get the fuck off the stage, you blue-eyed, limey fuck! Shut up, bitch!
Okay, we're trying to have a reasonable discussion! Fuck you!
Hi, Cenk. I'm not sure if you remember me. I was on your show a while back, and you asked me, demanded that I make you a ham sandwich, and I was just kind of wondering if you still wanted that sandwich. I could probably put it in the mail for you.
Okay, Karen, everybody knows I said that as a joke. Okay, and you didn't fucking make me a ham sandwich. That's bullshit. That's bullshit.
All right, let's stop right there. Now, that's him doing his imitation of Cenk, which if you've actually watched him and how he blew up at me, I thought it was all a joke before because they're one of the few shows that said, we're going to yell at you a little bit. Are you okay with that? It's not staged, but I said, sure, I'll yell back at you. You know, that's fine. I've probably been on their show more than 10 times, and they brought me up there, acted like it was a setup, acted like Roger Stone tried to take over. Roger's like 15 feet away in a hallway. Internet thought that we were like in their studio in L.A. and had invaded. No, it was like Radio Row, everyone 10 feet apart, crammed in to a parking garage that they put air conditioners in. So I don't know if this guy is crazy or what, but the point is, I don't want to make this whole interview about that. I want to get Steven Crowder's take on the election, on the debate, on you know, where this crazy world's going. But I got to tell you, the Young Turks are really pieces of work. So great job imitating him.
Well, thank you. It's always painful for me to go back and watch myself, but when I see that, I don't even see myself. I see Cenk in there. You know, it was really bizarre, that whole altercation with you and them, and I found it funny that someone who was Miss Body Positivity, strong feminist, went from zero to fat shaming in about like 2 seconds when she got mad with you right away. That was all she did. She just called you fat and swore at you and told you to get off. And then she's going to do a whole Young Turks piece about why we need to respect and ogle Amy Schumer's thighs. That I think that's the big issue. You use the term classically liberal. People my age, just they're tired of being told how to think, I guess. People who are younger, and I don't use the term classically liberal, namely because there's no tag for leftist on YouTube, so people get mad with the wordplay. But yeah, I think the Young Turks recently have been exposed. If you look at when I started on YouTube years and years ago, and you did, I think you guys started a little bit after and obviously grew much more quickly because, well, you guys are you. But the Young Turks were huge. They were wildly popular. They've attacked all of us very personally.
And they were always really backed by Google, always backed by Google, always pushed by the system.
Oh, yeah. We've had copyright claims just this week when we used newsworthy clips from the debates. Or whatever, or an interview, maybe it was before the debates, and they said, well, this isn't fair use. I go, if it's not fair use, the Young Turks don't have a show. All they do is turn on Fox News for 3 minutes and then bitch for about 5.5 minutes. That's their entire show. But of course, their stuff doesn't get taken down. So I think people are aware now with Facebook, with YouTube, with Twitter, though I think YouTube is better than most of those other entities because there is a system for recourse. People are seeing for the first time this push that is coming from the progressive left.
Sure, and that's why, very astute, Steven Crowder, that's where I was going. The reason I first played this clip, and I was about to say why I played it, is because the censorship, Michael Savage taken off 2 days ago for talking about Hillary's health. I talked to him. That's what happened. Okay, mm-hmm. This is really going on. The UN coming in and saying we want reparations for black Americans when the UN is literally displacing African tribes and killing them on record from Rwanda to you name it right now. I mean, talk about the pot calling the kettle evil. We have all this unfolding. We have total censorship in Europe. Classical tyranny calls to censor the internet. The UN gets control of the web in 3 days. I mean, these people are true authoritarians, it seems.
Yeah, absolutely. And I know you use the term globalist a lot, and then a lot of people take it and they don't really know what they're talking about. And when you set up everything as a globalist agenda, well, then when there's really a globalist problem, it sort of falls on deaf ears. The UN situation, when Barack Obama, I'm sure you covered this, went before them and said
last week.
Yeah, the U.S. is going to have to deal with some less freedoms for basically the greater good of the planet. That is actual. It's not a conspiracy. That is actual. The U.N., some form of a global governing entity, and Barack Obama saying that he is willing to give up American sovereignty and the rights of Americans who didn't sign off on this to appease the U.N., who might as well be called the I Hate America and Israel Club. Let's be honest. That is an issue I am dumbfounded that more media entities didn't pick up. And the same thing with the internet. I mean, listen, if you really want a true and free internet, unless you believe that you're going to be favored somehow, you should be absolutely mortified at this idea of the internet being.
And by the way, we have the George Soros emails, thanks to WikiLeaks, just right. from 5 weeks ago, that say we're going to use this UN takeover to favor our operations and shut down our competition. But forget that. We have Hillary's email 3 weeks ago saying the alt-right has no right to exist. So Stephen, let me bring this up since you kind of halfway, not really jab, but brought something up. I would watch world leaders at Davos online 6-7 years ago call for world government. I would come out and say it. People would say I was making it up. So I never said globalism was everything. And I know you're talking about other people.
Not you.
No. I mean, but other people do make stuff up. I agree with you. But the point is, it's so unbelievable. I don't blame folks for denying it's happening because it sounds so crazy. But now it really is happening. So I have to tell you, I felt like I was out on a limb 20 years ago talking about this. Now I don't. So let me ask you this question. What do you think starts to happen as the most radical concerns we had as libertarians or conservatives actually come true? What does that portend?
Gosh, it's a good question, especially in an era of someone like Donald Trump, where you know you see someone who could have some authoritarian tendencies on certain issues and certainly could be incredibly progressive in a good way on other issues, limiting government. Here's my point. I was saying, you know, for example, when I say, gosh, I was watching the debates and I've tried to be fair to someone like Donald Trump when I think he's right, support him when I think he's right, and criticize him when I think it's fair. I've been told that my career will be destroyed proactively by people, you know, in this sort of conservative movement. We could talk about that off air.
Nationalist populist movement. There are people that get really mad if you don't support Trump.
Well, a good example, like when I say, hey, oh, man, he dropped the ball on the no fly list answer.
I totally agree.
And then they go, well, that's because you're a globalist. No, that's where it's misused. I can disagree with Donald Trump on an issue, particularly domestic policy as it relates to the Second Amendment, and people just toss out globalist to anyone they disagree with. My point is, when you do that, it dilutes what you're talking about, what I'm talking about. Barack Obama standing in front of the UN saying, we are going to give up Americans' rights for the betterment, not even of the world, really the UN agenda. That is true world government globalism, and that is terrifying to me.
You're absolutely right. And now the administration admits that. And specifically, what you hit is absolutely on target, because we were talking before we went live. And you said, listen, I don't know if it's okay, but I'm going to go after Trump a little bit here. I mean, obviously he's better than Hillary, but I'm going to go after Trump because, you know, his no-fly thing. I said, hey, listen, stop and frisk. I don't agree with that either. He has some of these authoritarian leanings, but at least he's not a globalist, which just means wants to sell us out to multinational interest, wants to sign over our sovereignty, wants to do one-sided trade deals. I get those real problems. And I think those of us that really do support Trump have to, though, keep his feet to the fire and legitimately say where he's wrong. I mean, Hillary is wrong. Rahm Emanuel's wrong, who first came up with this, saying we'll just put you on an extrajudicial list and then not let you have guns. Well, no, that's totally anti-American, and Trump's wrong.
Right. Well, and what concerns me is the fact that he's gone back and forth on that, which tells me he doesn't really understand that issue. Listen, just because someone is put on an arbitrary list with no type of process that's disclosed, no appeal process that's even available, doesn't mean because you sort of say, well, we'll make it easier for them to get off. No, you don't get to take away someone's basic fundamental human right because of some arbitrary list created by the government. And the fact that he didn't, for me, that was the biggest headbanger moment from his side.
No, I agree.
The debate. I was really upset.
Well, the stop and frisk thing, too. I mean, I get these are high crime areas. I get it's people dressed in gangbanger garb, but it's still not due process. And I get that Chicago and places are falling apart. Right. Well, then how do you handle a place that has more murders than basically half the country combined, like Chicago, run by Democrats, and then people say, hey, start a stop and frisk, it cleaned up New York? I mean, I agree. It's unconstitutional. It's very authoritarian. I don't like it. But do I want 2,000 dead black people?
Right. Well, that's a good point you just brought that up. See, you had a legitimate criticism with Donald Trump and stop and frisk, and you explained it. What's the left criticism? It's racist! right? It's not racist. That's not the point. The point isn't, no, you can say it's unconstitutional. You don't have the right to do this. So the problem is, even when there are legitimate criticisms of Donald Trump or, of course, Hillary Clinton, the left has diluted. And then a lot of people who are ill-informed on the right have diluted it to the point where it's like, well, you're not making legitimate criticism.
So let me ask you this. Where is it going then?
Do you mean the election?
I mean, just all of it, because it seems like I was always more of a libertarian bashing Republicans and Democrats, but the Democrats really have, like, mutated into this just crazy town where that, I mean, I'll be out at an event and they'll have a gay pride parade and they'll run up and say, you're a homophobe. I've never bashed gay people. That's not my issue. I don't like them going in with their leftist agenda of gun control, you know, into the schools attached to it, but I'm not against them. And I say, where have I bashed people's right to live their lives? Well, you're a racist. You're a homophobe. Donald Trump's a homophobe. Donald Trump's never been that.
No, Donald Trump hasn't. Listen, I think of the legitimate criticisms of Donald Trump, the fact that he's a racist or a homophobe is not one of them. And so I think you're seeing the left shoot themselves in the foot. That's why they're going, bring out Zach Galifianakis in Between Two Ferns. Do the Joss Whedon video with all the celebrities we can get together. Here's something, too. I'm sure you've noticed and you'll enjoy. Remember, it used to be the Vote or Die campaign with P. Diddy and Cameron Diaz. And they came out and Drew Barrymore, they would say, I don't care who you vote for. I just want you to register and vote. Now they've come out and just said, you have to vote Hillary Clinton. So what's happened is this, it's really shined a light on the bias, the implicit bias.
Yeah, the pretense that they weren't biased is all gone.
That's all gone. And that's a wonderful thing. I will say this, politically, I don't know. This election, anyone who says they can predict it is, you know, listen, they don't have a crystal ball, and this is so unpredictable. The Clintons are the masters of the October surprise. It could go either way. So I don't try and in sort of dabble in that realm, because I know that if these people who are experts get it wrong half the time, I don't have a shot. I will say this. Politically, it could be dark for a while. Could not be. But it could be dark. The winning issues, I do think, where we are seeing progress, and sorry, the words are hard to use. I know you know where I'm coming from.
Yeah, they've taken all the words over, is we have crashed through political correctness. Trump has made it safe for people to break out of this little box. Is that what you're about to say?
No, I think there are four winning issues. If I'm advising a Republican candidate, guns are a big winning issue. Calling Islamic terrorism what it is, people can do that now.
Feminism, cutting taxes.
Well, I don't think with young people. I think the gender roles, this whole LGBTQ, AAIP, there's a rejection of that, and free speech. Those four issues are strong winning issues for the right, for libertarians, for conservatives. And I think they would do better to focus on that.
Well, they admit that Trump's done bad with millennials, but now they're slipping with Hillary.
Yeah. Well, that's just because it's Hillary who comes in. Hey, guys, I got hot sauce. Don't you like me, blacks? I mean, the pandering is just so easy to see with Hillary Clinton. With millennials, she's like the uncomfortable aunt.
It's like a weird granny who's really a James Bond villain. Since you mentioned this UN clip, it's a minute long. Here is the UN clip of Obama saying, you know, Americans, I got to get on them sometimes. They don't want to adhere to international standards right, that a bunch of offshore mega banks who literally are funding anti-gun programs here, that's who the globalists are. These big corporations that just want to play God, they want to have a corporate takeover of the free market, and they want Obama to sell us this idea to transfer our rights into these nebulous TPP agreements. Here it is.
But we have to put our money where our mouths are. And we can only realize the promise of this institution's founding to replace the ravages of war with cooperation if powerful nations like my own accept constraints. Sometimes I'm criticized in my own country for professing a belief in international norms and multilateral institutions, but I am convinced that in the long run, giving up some freedom of action, not giving up our ability to protect ourselves or pursue our core interests, but binding ourselves to international rules over the long term enhances our security. And I think.
Now, again, Stephen Crowder, along with Crowder.com, a TV radio host, what do you think we should do about these moves towards global government? What should we do about the Washington Post with the UN panel headed up by Saudi Arabia? That's a joke. Human rights panel saying white people owe black people for a history of racial terrorism. I mean, what if you're Russian in background and have no national history of even being connected to Africans? Still, you've got to pay reparations?
Yeah, I'm still listening to that. It's unbelievable. If I were to write a script of an evil leader, you know, who's trying to subvert the American system to globalism and write what Barack Obama just said, producers would say, this is too obvious. No one would ever say this, and they would toss it away. It is that bad at that point. They're saying it openly. As far as what they should, you know, the reparations thing is so silly. I was raised in Canada, too. So there is there's a race to victim culture right now. I mean, look at, you have Rachel Dolezal and Sean King competing to be black because they get a leg up. If you were a victim, an actual victim, if it were a disadvantage in the United States, you wouldn't have more and more people faking that they're black. You wouldn't have people who are biracial, people like Barack Obama raised to white parents who decide to identify and claim entire blackness. And then, of course, they say people like Ben Carson and Herman Cain aren't actually black. So the reparation situation is so
sure, silly, but also most whites immigrated to the U.S. after slavery, and most European countries have no connection, and England ended international slave trade. Saudi Arabia was the last country to supposedly get rid of it in 1968. Right. How in the hell is it always Muslims lecturing me that I am involved in the slave trade? I mean, this is crazy.
Well, why aren't they asking the African slave traders to give reparations if they're going to go back that far?
Exactly.
They sold them into slavery.
So are we seeing a peak in social justice warriors, or are we wrong? Is it about to get even worse?
Well, I hate to use it because that term peak oil, remember that was the scare tactic with climate change, peak oil, and it never happened. For people listening right now, I get criticized often because of they claim you're a climate denier, which I'm not. I just don't think the Kyoto Protocol or Bernie's tax plan would fix climate change. Remember, peak, there's more oil now than ever. There's more access.
Sure, that was
to
proven
more
to be bold.
Right, peak oil. So peak social justice warriors.
Yeah, how crazy will they get?
I don't know if they're in their death throes right now. It does depend on what happens with the education system. It does depend on what happens with, you know, if conservatives are able to continue getting a foothold, you know, obviously people like you, people like Paul Joseph Watson on YouTube and able to get that information out there. If that happens, I think we stand a chance culturally. It's still hard to fight against people who want free gimmies financially. That's why, you know, we look at our analytics. You know this. You have, I'm sure, robust analytics online. We can see on YouTube. We can see on social media, the website. A lot of the Trump people were Bernie people. Yes. So a lot of them were still, you know, that's sort of economic protectionism. And sometimes he kind of gives these veiled promises to unions, which I'm not super thrilled about. But you see a lot of young people who liked the free stuff from Bernie, like the what are you going to do for me, that sort of populism. But they were sort of social justice leftists. And so obviously there's been a flipping of the priority right now with sort of this adherence to populism. So I can't predict it, but like I said, I think those four winning issues are guns, gender roles, terrorist Islam, and free speech. If we can focus on those are winning arguments with the vast majority of millennials. Don't be fooled by the college students, the triggly puffs who just scream the loudest. I think they're a dying breed. I hope, Alex.
Well, but in a way, I don't hope, because it's so entertaining. I mean,
it is. It's tough when you show up on the show. Well, I don't know if you ever saw that clip. I showed up. I was Milo and Christina Summers, and I feel bad because
it was great.
Trigglypuff. But I came out, and I've done stand up my entire life, and she was giving me the finger. I don't know if I can, because I don't know if you have to blur it. So I don't.
No, it's incredible.
Do it.
You did an amazing job.
Well, she didn't. It was like she didn't have enough fingers to give, and I hadn't even said anything yet. That was, and if it seemed like I was mean to her, I hope people watching understand. My job is not to convince the crazy, so invested social justice leftists. You're wasting your time, but you can convert the 3-4 million people who saw that video and saw the hypocrisy.
Sure, it's like don't become this poor brainwashed person. By the cult that is modern liberalism, that is really authoritarianism, is really mind control. We'll be right back with a little bit more time with Mr. Crowder. But this is what he was mentioning earlier, Anna Kasparian from the Young Turds flipping out on me for no reason. We'll be right back. Stay with us on the other side.
A lot of the people that are picking on him for his weight gain aren't really lookers themselves.
Yeah.
Oh, and it's the classic bullying move where you want to feel better about yourself, so you look to someone and pick on their imperfections to feel good about yourself. It's stupid. She strikes me as someone who's actually trying to make a very serious and very terrible statement about overweight people. Look, I think that if someone that cares about you tells you, like, hey, let's get healthy together, it's not fat shaming. You know, fat shaming is pointing a finger at you and being like, you're fat. I think that this study is really fascinating because, I mean, I can relate to it big time because when I was about 4 years old, my dance instructor told me that I was overweight. And
Here's the deal, folks. These people are the biggest hypocrites in the galaxy. They are who they say they aren't. Studies show liberals are 6 times more likely to steal and more than 8 times more likely not to give donations. These are pigs. We'll be right back with Stephen Crowder. I'm Alex Jones with InfoWars.com, VladWithCrowder.com. Stay with us. There aren't many other big national talk show hosts, and I'm on less than 200 stations, but close to it. Savage is on over 400. There aren't many other hosts that have another host on, and Savage has me on his show. He has Paul Watson on. And until last week, he told me, hey, I want to air this segment. I go, great, you're fully authorized. He goes, no, Alex, I was talking to my producer. He goes, I know you let us play everything. You're awesome. I mean, we love it when he plays our stuff. He plays it like every week, our special reports. But he said, CBS is for the first time is shutting me down. And I said, elaborate. He said, I don't know how long I'm going to be here. And I've been talking to Savage. I mean, sometimes I have like 30-minute conversations with him. I've had 45-minute conversations with the guy, hour long before, you know, just sitting there talking on the phone. And he's never been alarmist, is what I'm saying. And I go, really? He goes, yeah, I may not be on very, you know, soon here. And then the next week, they cut him off WABC. They put guys on to make fun of him and say we've had a coup to set him up to make him get mad on air. He starts talking about it, and they cut him off 400 stations. And he's there on the internet finally at the end going, I'm not on air, I'm not on air. And they hadn't shut that off yet because he does his own internet streaming. He had to leave basically from the radio studio he was at to another one down the street because they'd cut that off. So I got to hand it to him. He's actually hooked into his different, you know, areas they don't control. But that happened. And then CBS goes, we don't know what's happening. This is exactly how they operate. And let me tell you, the censorship is intensifying. So that's why I love having somebody like Stephen Crowder, who has, you know, 80-year-olds watching him and a lot of other folks, but I happen to know just from going to soccer games or tennis things and, you know, like walk by and the kids are on their smartphones during a water break, you know, looking at ladderwithcrowder.com. My son, you know, I'll see the light on in his room. It's like 2 a.m. He's in there. I'm like, you're supposed to be doing homework on this computer, not watching, you know, Louder with Crowder. So that excites me because it's not just at my son's private school, public schools, you name it. And what he was saying earlier, young people, I mean, let's say 10 years old to 30, 35, they're really rejecting this modern cult liberalism because they weren't raised racist and they're sick of hearing all. It's like, what is this? It's making them uncomfortable. They recognize it as authoritarianism. So in the time we have with you, Stephen, let's talk about that because are we winning the war? I asked this question earlier. Are we winning the war or losing it, but specifically with young people? Because it seems like your demographic, Paul Watson's demographic, is, say, 30 years old down to about 10. And it's not embarrassing to have 10-year-olds watching. That's what the government wants. That's what the globalists want. They wish they could get 14-year-olds, you know. I mean, I'll go to some tennis camp with my son or some tennis tournament, you know, in New York, and you're there at breakfast, and there's kids from New York, and they're watching Louder with Crowder. That's exciting. They're watching Paul Watson.
Yeah, well, thank you. First off, for people watching, I know I'm going to get complaints if they don't know this is a derogatory shirt of socialism. It's a parody because I can see Twitter right now. Why are you supporting Che Guevara? Of course I don't. Thank you. I appreciate you saying that in the kind words. I will say that's been a big thing for us in getting big guests where it turns out their kids are fans. So people like, you know, I think we had Ted Cruz.
No, that's why I'm trying to get you on.
Well, I appreciate it. Yeah,
my son wants you on.
A lot of other hosts don't, so I appreciate it. You know, that's for us. A lot of times, hosts are like, "That guy's too edgy." So I'm trying to turn off my internet here so it doesn't screw with this feed. So I appreciate it, and tell your son thank you very much. I will say this: you know, to be young, I guess, in the sort of conservative movement. Well, you know, you were talking about AM radio or like Fox News. I mean,
no, you're the future, brother. I've been the guy that was the young guy. This is great. I mean, I want to win. I hope you get bigger than I am.
Oh, well, I don't know if that's in the cards, but I will say, you know, I was at Fox for a few years, right? And the median demo was like 72 and over.
Yeah.
And so without getting into too much inside baseball, I mean, listen, it's no secret that a lot of people there weren't big fans of what I did. You can look back and you can see me wearing a suit and a jacket and I'm uncomfortable because they needed to appeal to their base. And I understand that. There's nothing wrong with that business model. Our average viewer is a 28-year-old male online, you know, the millions of people who tune in and download and stuff. They're not numbers like InfoWars, but we're pretty happy that we're able to educate them. And obviously, I started out as a comedian and entertainer, but we really do try and bring them down the path. You know, our show is offensive to some people, and I'm sure your son has talked about that, but that's not the goal. To me, offense.
But it's okay. That's part of why they like it, though. It's good because right. It's better than The Daily Show or MTV, who Sumner Redstone admits is targeting my son. Thank God that Stephen Crowder and Gavin McGinnis have him instead of Sumner Redstone.
Well, gosh, can you believe Trevor Noah? Why do we have a South African telling Americans what they should do in regards to personal self-protection? It is unreal here what's happening with MTV and Comedy Central.
I mean, they admit, it's come out that they say, we're going to teach your 10-year-old how to be gay. It's like, I'm not against gay people, but I don't want anybody talking to my 10-year-old about sex, period. You're going to get punched in the nose.
Oh, I don't even know. Wouldn't that go against their narrative that you don't choose? Of course, you don't choose to be gay. How do you teach someone to be gay? It's just it's so silly. And here's the thing, too. This whole non-binary gender issue, LGBTQ, AAIP, they keep adding to the acronym. Like you were talking about with your son. Let me go back to the original question, because we could just talk all day about this. With the Black Lives Matter thing.
Oh, yeah. I want to bring that up. Boy, I mean, what a joke.
Well, here's the thing. Like your son, you said, is 11?
No. My daughter is 12. My son's 14, but he's been watching you since he was about 12.
Okay, so 14 years old. Here's the deal. When I was raised, Family Matters and Fresh Prince were the biggest sitcoms around. One dad was black families. One dad was a judge. One dad was a cop. These weren't black shows. These weren't BET shows. Most people who watched them were white people. So obviously at that point, white people were comfortable enough and liked these family-centric shows. I don't think you could do that today. When I was raised in a post-racial America / Canada, that's very different from today, where you have people who've made everything about race. I was talking about this with people. Look at Charlotte. When people see homeless people getting kicked, if you look at I don't know if it was Dartmouth, but the video I'm sure you guys ran where she was saying, I love your white tears. I want to see you cry, to the girl in the library. Here's the deal. That girl who's crying, maybe she's not a racist. But the guy next to her is seeing the Black Lives Matter activists being violent and saying they hate white people and white devil. And guess what? He's becoming a racist. And so my concern,
and the fact that the media doesn't decry it and legitimizes it, is going to create a bunch of white racism.
Yes, I think that this generation coming out, the younger millennials, will be far more racist than my generation or the generation before.
Oh, I agree. I was raised, I did not hear anything racial. In fact, my parents were more conservative Republicans, but Republicans were the folks that tried to end all this. It was like, there is some guilt. We need to have a free market. We need to hire people. We need to promote free market. We need to lift people up. You know, my grandma would always stop if she saw an old black lady walking down the road in the country and give her a ride. You know, there's definitely a white guilt there. But it was, we need to build these people up, my gosh, black groups are resegregating all over the country at colleges. It's sickening. So where is that going then?
That is a real worry to me. I do think that you could see more, and this is by design, right? Divide and conquer with Barack Obama. We have the first black president. I know I thought at least, like, all right, that's happened now. Maybe there'll be some healing so we can actually talk about the issues. No, it's gotten far worse, and that's by design. I do think you're going to see a pendulum swing. You're going to see a little bit more racism, unfortunately, with this younger generation. You can only have so many riots and so many hate groups, and like you've talked about,
so much flaming minority racism. The media has said, you know, it's white people's fault. Whites are inherently bad. They have family magazines coming out saying blonde hair is evil. I mean, you know, it's reached a crazy level.
I haven't heard of that.
Maybe I'm not kidding. I'm not kidding. It says if you see a blonde hair, blue-eyed family, look out and go confront them about their homogeneity.
Gosh. Well, you know, again, look back, like I was saying, Family Matters and Fresh Prince. When I was raised, it wasn't even really something that was thought about. No, it doesn't mean we don't need to be sensitive. Of course, there's a different experience for black Americans growing up, and you want to have a dialogue and be sensitive, but it's really hard to have that dialogue when they're turning over cop cars. And by the way, this isn't most black people. Again, this is a small minority who've grabbed the microphone.
That's,
and they're
bust in. That's bust
leftists.
In.
Yes.
So let me ask you this then. Why did the liberal media decide, because Hillary, even in the 2008 election, she was more law and order and all this stuff and wasn't pushing race war things. When did they decide the last 4, 5, 6 years to just go pure race? The old days, the KKK managed race through racist white people. They lost that when the Republicans passed the Civil Rights Act thing. So they flipped to represent minorities, but then it was this big kumbaya. When did it flip, double down, to go with race-based politics with minorities?
It's funny you should say that, because I predicted this, and I think we saw it somewhat, where it went from accusing all of your opposition of being racist with Obama to accusing them all of being sexist with Hillary. And we've definitely seen that, right? All of a sudden, the wage gap myth is a huge issue again. Everyone's talking about it, and it's silly. Of course, it's untrue. We don't even need to give that any airtime. But I think they're still continuing with the race issue with the Clintons, particularly because she's one of the weakest Democratic candidates if you look at the black demographics, because, right, with Bill Clinton, they incarcerated more black people than ever. Now, here's the deal. They have a 3-strike rule. I'm not even saying that that's necessarily a horrible thing. I think if you commit three serious crimes, preferably violent crimes, not three minor infractions, I think you probably should do some time. However, that did not play well with the black community. So blacks are primed and ready to dislike Hillary Clinton. So they were planning on going with the whole misogynist sexism wage gap. And then they said, oh my gosh, the poll numbers have come in. Black people really don't like you as much as they like Barack Obama. I know, let's drum up some more race wars and I'll tell them that I'm championing their cause.
And she was even going to go to Charlotte.
Yeah, with her hot sauce in her purse, she's going to fix the problem. The pandering with her, she doesn't even have the same accent, depending on who she's speaking with. It's just
I was about to ask you, why do you think she talks like a robot, a hillbilly one day, then it's bizarre, all these weird accents.
Well, this is what the left does, right? They're entirely run by polls. And that's why I have a problem with, you know, sort of this neo-populist movement where I still think principles are important to a degree because you don't want to be like the Clintons. I mean, you look at Joe Biden. They say, they're going to put you all back in chains. What? What, Joe? Why did you all of a sudden
sound like you're going to put y'all back in chains? Y'all back in chains? That would be very insulting. It's like when Rick Perry went and spoke to a Hispanic group in Mexico and he's like, hello, how you do? I mean, if you had some New Yorker come to give me a speech, I'd love them to speak in a New York accent. That's why I like Trump being himself. But if somebody came to Texas and went, I just got off the airplane in New York, and then, how you doing there, Alex? I would be insulted by that.
Yeah, I think Hillary Clinton is one step away from going to the border wall and talking to the immigrants with Senior Wences drawn in her hand. So tonight, we want your vote. Okay, senor, good job. She is so awful, and I think it's so plain. Here's the beauty, though, with Hillary Clinton. She's so bad at it that everyone sees it. So it's lifted the veil, I think, for a lot of people where they're going, all right, I get it. And the same thing with the accusations with Trump of racism, sexism. Everyone's going, yeah, but you know what? You said that about Mitt Romney, and you said that about John McCain, and you said that about George W. Bush.
What do you make about Lester Holt, 40-plus interruptions, only 6 for Hillary? I mean, that looked pretty skewed to me.
It did look skewed. I will say this. Donald Trump didn't clearly answer a few questions where if I were the moderator, I would have followed up as well. So I think it still was biased, but I think we need to be objective and say, all right, he didn't have a great second half and he was going around and they needed to be corralled in. And he was interrupting Hillary more than she interrupted him. I also understand that he was fighting two people. Listen. People said he was a registered Republican, Lester Holt. I don't know how true that is. And maybe he checked the box as a default box. With the debate, I thought Donald Trump was doing really well for the first 15 minutes. Again, objectively, if people want to tune into a show with cheerleading, I'm not the guy.
No, I agree. I thought the first 25, he won the debate. But overall, it's really hard to tell.
I don't think, ironically enough, I don't think he had the stamina later on. And it's like a good fighter. She's been to the championship rounds before. You know, you see that with, you know, Joe Rogan. Fighters are used to fighting 3 5-minute rounds. When you're fighting for a belt, it's 5 5-minute rounds. And fighters who haven't been there before, who look like a Greek god for the first 3 rounds, they're like a deer in the headlights. I think we saw that a little bit with Trump, and maybe he'll prepare a little bit better. So I understand what people are saying. I don't think this was as bad as a Candy Crowley moment. And I don't want people to jump on every, you know, whether it's Lester Holt, whether it's the microphone situation, because even you see it in sports, people will see it as whining, even if they're legitimate gripes. I'd rather see Trump put his head down, get to work and do better next time, because there is room for improvement.
I agree with you. And look, I like Trump. I know Trump. He's a populist. I like the fact that he's so blunt and honest about things, even things I disagree with. The fact that he's honest about it is a major plus. I've seen him change his view on things, not flip-flop, but when he's given more information. And I just think he's light years better than Hillary Clinton. The fact that the foreign governments, the Saudis, the Chinese communists are against him. And I think this is really Brexit 2 we're about to see. And I think Trump will win unless there's huge election fraud. Now, I want to go to a clip since you mentioned the black community. I have to tell you, I think it really is a misnomer that 90% of blacks really are supporting Democrats, because in my experience on the ground, it's 20-30%. And of all a lot of these classic hip hop stars, whether it's Ice-T or Ice Cube, they're pro-gun. They see through stuff. They're really smart. Here's what Ice Cube had to say. Donald Trump is what Americans love about the American dream. And then he talks about Hillary and the point you made about super predators. Here is Ice Cube.
Well, you know, Donald Trump is what Americans love. Donald Trump is what Americans aspire to be. Rich, powerful, do what you want to do, say what you want to say, be how you want to be. That's kind of been like the American dream. So he looks like a boss to everybody, and Americans love to have a boss. So, you know, that's his appeal to me.
So there you go. What do you make of that, Mr. Crowder?
Come out afterwards and say, by the way, I think Trump is horrible. And he said, so people took me out of context. But I do want to be fair with that. However, it does show you that there is a mob mentality where I think you're right. I think there are a lot more, particularly if you go to a church, like my family, they go to a church that's very mixed, probably 40% white, probably 30% black. And then, you know, everything else kind of filed in the middle. You'll have people who will step out and say, well, because of my principles, I can't vote for Hillary Clinton. And then they are excoriated. I mean, they lose family members. They won't talk to them anymore if they come out and say it. So,
well, sure, Trump's got problems. But, I mean, Hillary is a master James Bond criminal who's been caught lying and blowing up countries and working with radical Islam. I mean, she's so evil, I can't even believe it, quite frankly.
No, I think you're absolutely right. My point is, in the black community, even with that being said, if they come out and it even sounds like they're being positive about Republicans, it's just not allowed in the black community.
There's major bullying.
There is major bullying, and so I think those numbers would be different if they... Here's one thing. You want to talk about white privilege? Here's one thing. I was talking with Tommy Stoudemire on my show. I do have a privilege in the sense that as a white person, I can be called stupid or racist for being a Republican. However, as a black person, you are entirely expected to be a Democrat your entire life. And if you go against it, it causes rifts in families and friends. And that's one thing I don't envy with a lot of black people who are thinking independently, who may go for Trump or may go for Gary Johnson. If they're not going for Hillary Clinton, they're going to have a tough go with their circle of friends.
Exactly. And I'm going to be honest. I grew up in the gateway, you know, from the west to the south in Texas. You know, East Texas is the south, as south as it gets. The rest is, you know, the west. I mean, we really are in the middle here. And I grew up where I never heard racist talk. I mean, even under the breath stuff. In fact, I saw white guilt. I mean, I saw Salvation Army. I saw donating. I saw free medical care. You know, I saw it all, which I get. You try to lift up people and try to fix rifts, not even if you're guilty, just you're trying to do the right thing.
Right.
When I started getting around Democrats and traveling around the country and getting behind closed doors, it's like you think they're testing you and they start saying all this racist stuff. And they go, no, I am like that. And you're like, wow. And then you realize, wait, just 40, 50 years ago, these guys were the KKK. And I mean, it's just crazy to watch blacks and minorities worshiping them because they're selling a race-based system to them, which is, I guess, tribal when you know the history. Closing comments, 60 seconds.
Oh, gosh, 60 seconds. No, I think you're right about that. I think it's unfortunate more people don't know about it. I will say this. If racism is just as rampant as people talk about, this is anecdotal. I've heard the N-word used once, seriously in my life, and it was by a kid in West Virginia at a Bob Evans when I was doing a show. And I was like, oh, my God, I couldn't believe that I heard it, which just made me realize how rare it actually was in my interactions with Democrats, including people who are in current office, by the way, or at leftist shows. The racism, the prejudice of soft expectations, of assuming that these people are incapable and that they need them to come.
That's the real racism, is that these people have to be taken care of.
I see that so much, and it is grossly offensive to use the word.
It is. They want to control us. It's modern slavery. Steven Crowder, thank you so much for the time. Great job, my friend.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
You bet. We're going to be right back. Stay with us. We're going to bring the globalists down together, my friends. Okay, we have massive breaking news. This is going to go into the next hour with Roger Stone. I saw him texting me frantically earlier, and then Nico ran in during the break, and he said, have you seen this? We have the clip from C-SPAN. I saw Comey during the break. On national news, the FBI director is being grilled over the fact by Republicans that they never intended to go after Hillary. They gave him all immunity. It was all staged. Representative Nadler asked the FBI about something I was told about 3 weeks ago by Roger Stone. We're getting on the line right now. And then I had already been contacted by some Pentagon sources and others saying, listen, you've got the Justice Department looking at you. And I said, for what? And they were like, threats to Hillary and Russia. Now, I know my phones are tapped, too, because a lot of weird stuff's been going on. And, I mean, I have no connection to Russia other than the fact that Russia doesn't want to be under the New World Order, neither do I. I mean, it's just crazy. Okay, it's crazy. There's a lot more I don't want to get into here, obviously. The leaks we've gotten are from, like, the Secret Service and stuff. But I told you, this is dangerous what we're doing, okay? We're not playing tiddlywinks. That's why we need your prayers. We need your support. InfoWarsLife.com. We have the new super probiotic biome defense everybody needs. A lot of other great products, books, videos, water filters, non-GMO seeds, air filters. This is, I mean, the best products. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com, 888-253-3139. They just shut down Michael Savage. We're going to play his last two interviews with us or clips of it the next hour with David Knight. But We're going to play a clip going out to break and then come back with Roger Stone. Some stations don't carry the fourth hour. A lot do. Infowars.com/show. But this is from Media Matters, which is the White House. You've got David Brock connected to all this embezzlement and, you know, taking money and going around the 501c3 and all the rest of it. That's okay. But then the fact that Roger Stone, they're trying to claim, works for the Russians, and by extension that we're being looked at for working for the Russians, just shows how crazy this has gotten. So let's play 2 minutes of this exchange. Come back to Roger Stone here in just a moment. We just got on the line. This just happened about 30 minutes ago. Here it is.
Questions about that. In his early remarks, Mr. Conyers referenced an August 30th letter from the ranking members of a number of House committees. That letter asked whether the FBI was investigating troubling connections between Trump campaign officials and Russian interests, and whether they contributed to the illegal hacking of the Democratic National Committee and the Democratic National Campaign Committee. You're familiar with that letter, I take it?
Yes, I'm familiar with the letter.
I'd like to ask you a few questions. The letter said this, and I quote, on August 8th, 2016, Roger Stone, a Donald Trump confidant, revealed that he has communicated with WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange about the upcoming release of additional illegally hacked Democratic documents. Mr. Stone made these statements during a Republican campaign event while answering a question about a potential October surprise. Obviously, if someone is stating publicly that he is in direct communication with the organization that obtained these illegally hacked documents, I assume the FBI would want to talk to that person. Has the FBI interviewed Roger Stone about his communications with Julian Assange or his knowledge of how WikiLeaks got these illegally obtained documents?
I can't comment on that.
Mr. Stone stated that he has knowledge about upcoming leaks of additional illegally hacked documents. Has the FBI asked him about those communications?
I also can't comment on that.
Because it's an ongoing investigation?
I don't want to confirm whether there is or is not an investigation. That's the way I answered Mr. Conyers' questions as well.
Director Comey, the FBI acknowledged in public statements and testimony that it was investigating Secretary Clinton's use of a private email server, and that was while the investigation was still ongoing. Now you can't comment on whether there's an investigation. Is there a different standard for Secretary Clinton and Donald Trump? If not, what is the consistent standard?
No, our standard is we do not confirm or deny the existence of investigations. There's an exception for that when there is a need for the public to be reassured. Obviously, it's apparent given our activities, public activities, that the investigation is ongoing. But our overwhelming rule is we do not comment except in certain
circumstances. That's enough. We're going to go to break and come back with Roger Stone in 70 seconds. And again, it's one thing to be told about this, another thing to actually see it happening. They're trying to claim Trump is a Russian agent, ladies and gentlemen. And you've seen them on national news say that I'm a Russian agent with Trump and what's the other guy? Vladimir Putin. Well, if you just joined us, we've started the fourth hour here. I was going to air large excerpts of the last two interviews with former CBS talk show host, I guess, Michael Savage, who got taken off the air in New York and then nationwide when he complained Monday for talking about Hillary's health problems and the fact that WikiLeaks says she had Parkinson's medication. But now we have global government forming, globalists running our nation. And then if we want nationalism like the Brexit, like the UK does, we're Russian agents. And they even said Farage is a Russian agent. So if the EU doesn't want to, you know, be kicked out of England, they just come and say you're a Russian agent. Same thing with the globalists here in America. We've been occupied by this. Roger Stone, this is getting crazy, especially when you and others privately told me that the Justice Department was poking around, you know, claiming that we're Russian agents. I was then told this by two different sources. Separately, they said, man, the Democrats are sending letters to the Justice Department, and they're concurring and sending it to the FBI and others to investigate you for basically insurrection and working for the Russians. Now, I was told this last week by a source and another source this week, and these are good sources. So this has reached a level of authoritarianism that is over the top. There is no doubt if Hillary gets in, she's coming after us. I mean, this is ridiculous. What do you say to the charge of we're working for the Ruskies?
Well, this would be laughable if it wasn't so outrageous. This is the new McCarthyism. I mean, Congressman Jerry Nadler is a pathetic hack and a shill for Hillary Clinton, willing to overlook all of her illegal activities to try to launch a witch hunt to non-existent activities. I have no connections to the Russians. I don't work for the Russians. I'm not in touch with the Russians. I am not compensated by the Russians. My loyalty is to the United States of America. If the FBI would like to investigate my ties to WikiLeaks or the Russians, they're welcome to do so. They'll find nothing untoward or illegal. I have, as I've said on this program many times, had a back-channel communications with Assange through an intermediary simply for the purpose of gleaning information as to what he may or may not have.
And by the way, you got hacked, your bank, everything because of that.
Yes, but, you know, I didn't hear from the FBI when I got hacked or when they destroyed my contacts or destroyed other investigative documents I was working on or invaded my bank account where there were actual thefts of thousands of dollars in illegal transfers. The FBI didn't seem to be too concerned about that. On August 21st, a bunch of Democratic hacks co-signed a letter to Comey demanding that I be investigated. These are intimidation tactics that will not work.
And let me ask you this question. I mean, obviously, we brought this up privately, but just in a vague way that we were both under investigation. I've been told this, too, before this even came out. And I'm just sitting here. I'm not even upset about it. It's so ridiculous that I'm a Russian spy. I mean, give me a break.
Well, as Nietzsche said, that which does not kill me makes me stronger. Alex, every time they attack you, and Hillary Clinton attacked you by name in a speech, which I'm jealous about, I got to be honest, they're only boosting your viewership, which I think has probably tripled in the last couple of weeks. Every time they attack you, they just underline the fact that you're a truth teller. And every time they attack me and want...
I agree, but I mean, it's like...
effective in bringing down the globalists.
I agree. Let's come back.
It's a badge of honor.
Let's come back and play a short clip of this and then talk about what this means 40 days until the election. What are the other dirty tricks they're going to play? And I guess it's just a form of intimidation. You know, it's like... We're investigating you in that picture. We're investigating what you did here. We're watching you. And it's just like, I know you're watching me. All I want to do is get our country back. Can you people just stop being such criminals and following this collapsing witch's orders? Because we're not going to stop. So whatever you're going to do, feel your damn hand. We'll be back. Only 40 days left. I'm your host, Alex Jones. This is the InfoWar. I've got so much to talk about in the short segment with Roger Stone. Just an hour or so ago, this was the FBI director. It's a big national news story coming up in papers everywhere, and they've got it with headlines. Roger Stone, WikiLeaks, Russian agent. And again, I've been getting the calls, people saying, man, people are going around asking if you're planning an overthrow of the country with the Russians. I mean, they're really trying to sell this crazy idea. And this just shows these are globalists selling our country out, and they're saying we've sold out to the Russians because Russia's one nationalist country, like the UK fighting back against this takeover. I'm not a British agent either. I don't want globalism running me. Yes, okay? Here's a clip.
2016, Roger Stone, a Donald Trump confidant, revealed that he has communicated with WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange about the upcoming release of additional illegally hacked Democratic documents. Mr. Stone made these statements during a Republican campaign event while answering a question about a potential October surprise.
That's what journalists do.
Obviously, if someone is stating publicly that he is in direct communication with the organization that obtained these illegally hacked documents, I assume the FBI would want to talk to that person. Has the FBI interviewed Roger Stone about his communications with Julian Assange or his knowledge of how WikiLeaks
got
these illegally
hacked documents? And it goes on and on, and the director says he won't answer it because there's an ongoing investigation. Roger, you've been public. You're a journalist. You run StoneColdTruth.com. You're a best-selling author. You said through an intermediary, you're trying to check info you got on Hillary with Assange. You've always been out in the open. We've contacted and talked to Assange before. We've talked to, you know, Nigel Farage, you name it. This is crazy. I mean, I have NSA whistleblowers on. I mean, I'm going to be investigated because I'm a journalist? Go ahead.
Yeah, it has a Kafka-esque quality to it, but here's what I would say to Congressman Nadler, as Alger Hiss said to Richard Nixon when he was in Congress. Jerry, say it outside the immunity of your congressional office, and I will sue your fat ass so fast your head will spin. Go ahead, accuse me of treason. Let's fight it out in a federal courtroom instead of hiding behind your congressional immunity. This is an absurdity. And we now have a political FBI and a political CIA that have been entirely politicized and now seem to be extensions of the Clinton campaign. It's insulting if it weren't so ridiculously absurd.
Roger, did you get, like her chief of staff or she did, $35 million from the Russian government to sign over concessions to one-fifth of U.S. uranium when you were Secretary of State?
That's the real irony here. The only one who's actually in touch with Putin, the only one who's done errands for the clique around him, are the Clintons, who, as you've just pointed out, took millions in order to assign the uranium concession, 70% of our production, to a Russian conglomerate that is controlled by the Kremlin.
And by the way, I don't want to give mainstream media credit, but in the last 3-6 months or so, there's been a bunch of articles, even the Wall Street Journal, even the Associated Press, admitting that investigation showed massive Hillary connections to the Russians, which is their interest. That's what they're doing. I'm not saying we shouldn't be tougher on them. I mean, you know, they're like the Chinese, you know, going to these traders and, you know, selling us out. But it's not Trump. It's Hillary. And WikiLeaks says we've got the documents. No Russian connection to Trump. Zero.
And no Russian connection to WikiLeaks for that. That's the other canard here. Julian Assange is not working for the Russians or the Chinese or the Americans. He's working for himself. He's working against the deep state, which is why I think he's a hero.
He is a hero.
A truth teller.
There's no doubt he's a hero. He has gone through hell. Okay.
And right now they have these trumped up charges of sexual assault against him, which is completely fraudulent. And now before the Swedish Supreme Court, it's merely an attempt to silence him. It's so ridiculously obvious. Look, Alex, I think they're particularly upset because my book, The Clinton's War on Women's, out in paperback this week. It is selling gangbusters. It is now affordable to send to women. I'm going to send PDF versions to women voters in key states by email. This is driving them insane, but they need to read the First Amendment, and then when they're finished,
sure,
they need to reread it.
Well, that's the truth. They have a big raging hard-on for you because they know your talking points are reality-based, the opposite of a dirty trick, and that Trump's listening, the world's listening, and most of what Trump has scored giant points on, quite frankly, came right from Roger Stone. I'm very proud some of it came from me. Obviously, Trump researched and resonated with it. He's his own man. But let's just say it. They figured out where the real points are getting scored against him, and they're pissed.
Yeah, I think that's essentially true. And let's be clear. We're not even close to finished yet. Don't try to call this race 40 days out. There are some very large events happening that are going to expose Hillary Clinton and her husband. And this race is far from over. Now what we have is this giant groupthink going on in the mainstream media. I watched the debate, and then I read today's New York Times. It's obvious to me that they must have watched a different debate.
Trump won every poll but CNN. And I would say he won it moderately. It blew up in their face that it was so rigged, so he ended up winning bigger. But
well, and can she debate at all without an earpiece? Because that's my question.
She clearly had it. So did Holt. We've confirmed that. Let me ask you this question then. I mean, I think from the polls we're seeing, Trump is still moderately ahead in swing states. He's not as good as he was a week ago. I would call this kind of a, you know, Pyrrhic victory he had at the debate. He says he's going to be a lot more hardcore. You're always very honest. You said this is Trump's to lose. Trump is going to be the winner. You said that 2 weeks ago. Is that still the case?
Well, it's a little early to gauge the outcome of the debate because you can't measure the speed of the wind in the eye of the storm.
You have to
wait until things settle down. But I addressed a political science class last night at the University of Maryland, pardon me, the University of Miami, 350 students. And I spoke to a very prominent Democratic pollster who I respect prior to this, and he told me that new surveys that he has seen show Trump surging among Hispanics, now at about 35% in key states. I would remind you, Mitt Romney topped out at 29. This is why they're so panicky. Trump was on the move. Remains to be seen what the result was of last night or Monday night's debate. That said, I don't expect a seismic change. You might have a small incremental change, but anybody who thinks this race is over or that Trump doesn't have adequate opportunities to gain ground, doesn't understand American politics.
Let's talk about our October surprises. We do have one that's going to be an October surprise. We're going to go ahead and release it in October. And that's what's got them freaked out, is that we're not with WikiLeaks. We're checking facts with WikiLeaks if we're able to. But that's coming out in the next few days. We ought to just release it now. It is dangerous. It's not that big a deal. It's actually confirmed and known, but it just brings it back up. What are some of the other October surprises we've got cooking? I mean, not specifically, but why they should be worried. And what do you think they may do? Clearly, quadrupling down with race riots, tripling down with division, George Soros, Ford Foundation, hundreds of millions, you know, to take every unfortunate event and hype it up. What are some of their other surprises? Wars. I know they've had articles in CNN and others going, oh, Trump thinks he's going to win. There's something big about to happen that'll really shake him and Hillary. What's the inside baseball, Roger Stone?
I think that there's an orchestrated attack today by this Hispanic former Miss Universe that appears to me largely to be disinformation. Hillary put her thumbprints all over this in the debate. You could see that Trump was kind of taken by surprise. I think that's because the entire thing is fictional. My major concern...
Well, let me just say, I like her at 160 instead of 110. I like her juicy.
Yeah, well, I'm the same way because, you know, baby got back. But just the same, my major concern continues to be the rigging of this election, and therefore we are very shortly at Stop the Steal going to unveil a very detailed exit poll program for which we have already signed up thousands of volunteers, and we need more. But we have working with political scientists and mathematicians come up with an exit poll program that will allow us to immediately gauge whether there has been vote rigging and reveal it on Infowars.com so the world will know, giving Trump the basis on which to challenge the election's results if, in fact, he's been cheated. Now, that cannot be done without hard evidence, but I think if it happens, the hard evidence will be had.
Sure, so, sure. Well, we've got, as you just mentioned, the former poster child, or current poster child, is a porn star who admitted that she was the getaway driver for a bank robbery. So this lady's running around when she was Miss Universe. She gained a bunch of weight, wasn't doing her job. Trump wanted to renege on paying her because she wasn't doing her job. He says she's become a little piggy. She eats too much. Well, I mean, that's the case. Big deal if you got a model that's supposed to be doing work for you and she gains a bunch of weight, and then Trump gets out of the contract calling her Mrs. Piggy. I mean, Hillary has Muslims chopping women's genitals off.
Well, I guess my question is that less objectionable to the fact that Bill Clinton raped and bit Juanita Broderick and then Hillary threatened Juanita to her face, squeezed her hand so hard it hurt, and essentially told her to keep her mouth shut? So, and I think there are similar stories by Kathleen Willey, whose home is broken into, whose children are...
Absolutely. Roger Stone.
Killed, ...whose car is vandalized, or Paula Jones, who got an $850,000 civil settlement payment from the Clintons after which he was suspended from the practice of law. Is any of the allegations about Trump and Miss Universe more serious than those transgressions? I don't think so.
Well, we need to get more comfortable in this country to sit there and joke around and do things like this. And it's this one-sided playing field where it's like we're in junior high. Oh, he called somebody, you know, a little piggy, or they're eating too much like a pig because they've gained 50 pounds. You know, he's like, hey, you gained a bunch of weight. You're not out there doing a job for Miss Universe.
But let's be candid about what's happened. Everything that the Clintons do, everything is carefully polled and focus grouped and roundtabled. So this whole attack on Trump is aimed at a specific cohort of women within the voters, and it may test well. But
this is gained at making women that are overweight mad.
But it will not test as well as Juanita Broderick when she goes public. Because she's imminently more believable than Hillary Clinton, or Paula Jones, or Kathleen Willey, or Sandra Allen James, or Liz Ward Grayson, or Eileen Wellstone, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Who's an abuser of women? Not Donald Trump, Hillary and Bill Clinton. That's who.
Well, I want to invite this lady in studio. We'll fly her here. We We want to get her here in studio just to discuss how evil Trump is.
I think you'll get them all, Alex. I think they're all anxious to talk. I think they were waiting till October. And I believe Saturday's October 1st.
Well, let's have the victims of this all on and then have this porn star lady on and ask her, you know, was him calling you a little piggy saying you're eating a little too much is why I got out of your contract? And, you know, I mean, obviously, if you're in a contract to be skinny and wearing a bathing suit, and you go gain 50, 60 pounds, you know, Trump got out of the contract. So, that I mean, I loved how they were sitting there bitching going, there was an architect that Trump said violated a contract, and he's here tonight. He didn't get paid full price for a clubhouse. Meanwhile, this woman has wrecked countries, killed hundreds of thousands of Christians, cattle futures, scams, murders, death, been part of Obamacare, Benghazi, all these other crimes. The Glass-Steagall Act they got rid of, the banking crisis. Well, she's one of the big authors, and then she's blaming him over a clubhouse. When this woman, Trump should have said, I'm bad. You only gave 5.7% of the money for Haitian refugees to charity. You kept 90%+, you pig. Sorry.
Yeah, no, Black Lives Matter, unless, of course, you live in Haiti or Libya. But I guess if the FBI Director Comey and his bureau aren't too busy investigating me, they might want to look into why Hillary took $10 million from Ukrainian billionaire Viktor Pinchuk and then approved Pinchuk's goons driving the democratically elected president of Ukraine, whose election we recognized as a country, out of office at gunpoint. Not in an election, not by impeachment, but at gunpoint.
And let's go further. We have this administration involved with the Saudi Arabians and all the corruption they're involved. It just goes on and on.
Well, here's how I would wrap this up, Alex. You said correctly, if they're elected, they're coming after us. Well, let me say this. If they're elected, we're coming after them. This fight doesn't end on November 3rd unless Donald Trump is elected. And then, frankly, he can clean up the mess that they have created.
Well, let's take Ukraine. I mean, and then we'll close. The son of the vice president, as soon as they overthrew the country, took over the multi-billion dollar a month, worth tens of billions a year, gas company that the Russian gas passes through and began grabbing hundreds of millions for himself on record. Why is it the FBI investigating the vice president giving his son the contract over the stolen gas? I mean, these people, the Clintons stole George Washington's China. Okay, they are the lowest white trash filth you can imagine.
That's why I say lock her up. To be continued.
All right, Roger Stone, both the Bill Clinton rape shirt and Hillary for prison shirts, both limited editions, are available at InfoWarsStore.com. Roger, we'll talk to you soon.
Great to be here, Alex. Many thanks.
You bet. I'm going to hand the baton to David Dunn, who's been waiting in the wings. We've got segments of the interviews we've done in the last 2 weeks with Michael Savage, because he's off the air now, and he won't talk to anybody. I don't know what's going on. All I know is he told me CBS was censoring him a week before it happened. And I mean, my God, hope if we go away, people are more concerned about it, because this is just crazy. David Knight, what do you make of all this going on? I mean, this is really, really getting nuts, because I don't go on air and tell people that I've been told that the Justice Department's investigating me for plans to overthrow the government, even though they've already overthrown our government, and there were Russian agents. I don't even really speak a word of Russian. I'm just going to say goulash. That's pretty tasty, like a soup or something, like a roast soup or something my mom makes. But, I mean, it's just crazy to watch these globalists that have sold the country out to multinationals calling us Russian agents, David Knight.
Alex, what we just heard about Roger Stone being brought up in the FBI hearings. I already had on my list of things to cover here Comey cronyism and the fact that he was going to be brought before Congress today to ask answer questions about his specialized treatment of Hillary Clinton. As Wall Street Journal pointed out, it really has become a kid glove exercise. But that's the real issue, Alex, is that the FBI has become politicized. Even Politico, who is totally in the tank for Hillary Clinton, has talked about how he has politicized the FBI unlike anything that we've seen since J. Edgar Hoover. And that is a fact. If you go back and you look at the close connections between Loretta Lynch and James Comey, they go back far before they became attorney general and FBI director. They were part of a law firm. They used to do the Clintons' taxes.
Yeah, these are Clinton minions that have been put in place.
That's right.
To carry all this out. And
And they allowed Sandy Berger, the guy who, as part of the 9/11 investigations, wanted to cover up some information.
Stuff out of Congress.
Yeah, he went to the National Archives, stuffed documents in his clothes, down his pants, took them out and destroyed them. He got off without anything happening to him. Who was in charge of that investigation? Loretta Lynch and James Comey. That is precisely what Hillary Clinton has been doing. It was a small example, a physical example, sure, of what Hillary Clinton has been doing with this other stuff.
Well, they're arrogant. They think they're invincible. Even if they steal this election, they've just discredited themselves. I'm going to hand the baton over to you. I need some segments. We might be able to air it all. Michael Savage, you want to get your take on that as well. But we have the new Biome Defense, amazing probiotic out. It's a whole new system of probiotic using the European technology that's in medical clinics, you name it. It's amazing. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. Recall toll-free, 888-253-3139. Free shipping store-wide ends today. A lot of other specials just ended. Some new specials are out. Be sure and check out the new specials at InfoWarsLife.com. That's InfoWarsLife.com or toll-free, 888-253-3139. And please pray for the broadcast and spread the word. Get the free app at InfoWars.com/app. Get a lot of other specials and special videos, articles, coupon deals, and more when you sign up for the free newsletter at InfoWars.com/newsletter. Back to David Knight, Nightly News Tonight, 7 o'clock Central.
As we were talking about earlier, I was already had it on my list of things to talk about. First thing I wanted to talk about was James Comey. And this article from the Wall Street Journal points out that today he was going before the House Judiciary Committee. They said he'll get another chance to explain his agency's double standard regarding Hillary Clinton. And they pointed out that we had a lot more documents that were released on Friday evening. This is the way he does it. Every time there's a holiday, whether 4th of July or Labor Day or weekends, that's when he releases the information. Now, what have we seen lately? Okay, we've seen that the FBI granted immunity to Clinton's top aides, Chief of Staff Cheryl Mills, Senior Advisor Heather Samuelson. They did that in order to get them to surrender their laptops. And as some of these congressmen are saying, you just take the laptops from anybody else. You don't have to give them immunity deals. And why does the FBI give people immunity deals? They always do that to people who are further down so they can get information to get the people who are running the RICO operation or the criminal operation. They always give immunity to the people lower down so they can get details to get the people at the top. Yet we've seen this before with the Clintons. Remember back in the 1990s when we had the scandals with Charlie Tree and so forth? Charlie Tree was given immunity at that time. They found out everything that Charlie Tree knew, and yet they didn't go after the Clintons at the top, even though he implicated them. So, again, we're seeing these people like Cheryl Mills, Heather Samuelson, are given immunity so that they'll merely hand over their laptop. And as the lawyer for these two, they both have the same lawyer, incidentally, she said the immunity deals were designed to protect her clients against any related classification disputes. Now, the Wall Street Journal says this is an admission that both women knew their unsecured laptops had been holding sensitive information for more than a year. In other words, violating national security. They say, meanwhile, the FBI waited until late Friday to dump more documents from its investigation that raised even more questions. Was the FBI concerned that Ms. Mill, in the fall of 2013, after Congress began investigating Benghazi, called Mr. Pagliano to ask about software that could be used for wiping computer data? Or that Platte River Networks employee, after getting instructions from Ms. Mill to begin deleting Clinton emails that were more than 60 days old, entitled the resulting work ticket, the Hillary cover-up operation. Well, today, he told them, even before he started talking about Roger Stone and Alex Jones, the Red Scare that they're trying to gin up here, he said, no, that wasn't a cover-up at all. Asking for information about covering up stuff for a VIP isn't a cover-up. We're not weasels, he said. Yeah, they are. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and in this half hour, we're going to play for you some excerpts from when Michael Savage talked to Alex Jones just a couple of days ago. Now, why are we doing this? It's because the authoritarian left is coming out with, every day, we see a new form of censorship. What happened on Monday was that Michael Savage began discussing Hillary Clinton's health issues. He thinks that it's Parkinson's disease. As he got into that discussion, and of course, this is the day of the big debate coming up, as soon as he got into that, the big station, WABC Radio TV in New York, shut him off and then put on a lesser-rated Curtis and Kuby show. Shortly after that, he found out that he had been shut off in New York, and he began talking about it to the remainder of his audience. And he's got 400 stations, 20 million listeners. He starts talking about it to the other 399 stations, and then they cut him off nationwide. See, that's the way they handle this. Another example of this, very small example, but still very significant. Remember Donald Trump Jr. tweeted out a Skittles meme that said, hey, here's a bowl of Skittles. If we told you three of these are poison, would you take a handful? He said, that's our Syrian refugee problem. The fact that we cannot vet which ones are okay and which ones are violent criminals. And that has created a big stir. And now they have removed that tweet. Again, they don't want to debate it. They just want to censor it. That's the authoritarian left. They've removed that tweet saying that they have a copyright violation of the image that was used in that meme. Now understand, that is fair use, what he did there. It is not only political commentary, but it is also satire. Both of those, either one of those would be protected speech, but both of those together would protect that. Nevertheless, they take that down because that's the kind of censorship you see. That's what we see happen to Paul Joseph Watson's video last week, and yet it gets bigger when they do that. But here's Alex Jones and Michael Savage talking about the issues just last week, the same issues that we've now seen happen this week.
How many more attacks have to happen from Muslims till we realize that it's not happening in a vacuum and it's not happening because of evil Donald Trump or because of Michael Savage or Alex Jones? You know, on my Facebook, I get this from the idiots, the liberals. They say, you know, if we didn't provoke them, if we didn't put them down, if we didn't demonize them, they wouldn't do it. And I have to patiently say, study your history. Islam has been at war with the world for 1,400 years. They don't learn that at Harvard. They don't learn that at Yale. They don't learn anything. So they don't know that Islam is a warlike, militant, political machine. And they've used the First Amendment, freedom of religion, to infiltrate and conquer every nation they've ever entered. In this country, for example, I was thinking about that this morning at dawn, Alex. I had an amazing sunrise this morning on San Francisco Bay. It looked like fire. I put it up on my Facebook page. It was one of those fire sunrises. And all I could think about was how, not the Trojan horse metaphor, but specifically freedom of religion. And I said, wait a minute. There are limitations on freedom of speech, aren't there? In other words, you can't yell, kill this or kill that. You'd be taken off the air in 1 second and probably arrested. I have limitations. I have an internal auditor in my head, an internal censor. I don't say certain things because I know that I wouldn't last in the business for 22 years. So who says that religion should be protected 100% by the First Amendment? For example, what if psychos wake up one day, as they have, and they say they're a witch and they're a religion? Well, then, hey, you got warlocks now practicing witchcraft in the army. This is showing you how sick the country has become. Fine. Well, now let's say someone comes up with a religion and says, my religion says you can kill anyone who's not like us. Is that a religion? Sure. You got the protection of your religion. How about I can rape young children? Sure. It's a religion. No, it isn't. So in other words, if a religion woke up or created or someone created a religion of child molesting, everyone would say, I'm sorry, that's not a religion. If religion said you can kill anyone who's not like you, they said that's not a religion. Really? Well, look into Islam. It says kill the infidel in about 73 different places. If you find the infidel, slash his throat. Kill the Jew, kill the Christian, kill the apostate. So I'm saying right now what moderate Muslims are saying, and I've had some of these people on, mainly they're women, by the way. I've often said, Alex, only the Muslim women can save us from these animals.
Why are we bringing people from countries that are in perpetual war, the most radical Muslim countries with these Sunnis and Wahhabists, where they're constantly just killing themselves, killing their wives and daughters, pouring acid on each other's faces? They're clearly lunatics. They're clearly under a 1,400-year cult. And so we shouldn't be bringing people here from the region of cult crazies.
How many Muslims have come in under Obama Clinton? She was Secretary of State. I think the number was something like 681,000 Muslims have been brought in under Hillary Clinton. Now, how many of them? I keep hearing most of them are peaceful. Fine. Okay, most of them are peaceful. So what is it, 1% are radicals? What's 1% of 700,000 rounded off?
A lot of people.
Oh, what? Well, 10? Do the math faster. You said doing the fifth grade. 700,000, 10% of 70,000. 1% of 7,000. So about 7,000 yes. of them are now, 7,000 radicals they brought in. So it's no way, Savage, no, it's not 1% of Muslims are radical. No, no, it's 0.1%. Arkansas, it's not 7,000. It's only 700. So they brought in 700 more terrorists. No, Savage, it's not 0.1%. It's 0.01%. All right, so it's not 70, it's 7. You see what I'm saying? But you still.
But we know the numbers. This latest group, decades ago, it was heretics. It was people that did actually want to live in a freer country in most cases, who are fleeing Islam and were just Islamic with their roots. I've studied it. I know you've studied it. I've had scholars on. Now it's the worst third world areas that they're coming out of, where they're constantly killing each other. It's a bunch of Sunnis who invaded Syria, got their butt kicked, and now are coming through Turkey into Europe, into the United States. Interpol admits, as you know, Dr. Savage, 80% are military-age men. And when they do polls in Europe, upwards of 35% say they will support jihad and suicide bombing. Now, so 35% are terrorists.
Tell me that one of these things has not magnified under this cretin in the White House. Is this not becoming a third world nation of terror? Check yes. Riots? Check Black Lives Matter. Mobs? Check Black Lives Matter. Chaos? Check Barack Obama. Terror, riots, mobs, and chaos. This is a novelty in American history. I haven't seen anything like this historically since the 60s. And before that, when was the last time you've seen America like this? And the beauty of all of this, Alex, is how he's gotten away with it, because you've got to give him credit. Barry Obama is the slickest salesman of communism the world has ever, ever discovered. No screaming, no yelling, no threats, just a silk smooth, good looking, nice guy with a lovely wife and children, selling the most evil poison the world has ever, ever been asked to ingest. And look how far he's gotten. And every time he gets away with another outrage against this nation, he raises the stakes like a junkie. He needs a higher dose of insult in order to maintain the high. Am I wrong, Alex?
You're dead on, Mr. Savage. Dr. Savage, please continue.
So the question is, okay, I'm complaining about him. I'm saying she's worse, which is true, which is ludicrous. She says America wants change. From what? From the same policies she's going to continue? She's suddenly not a progressive lunatic? Wait a minute. She's going to change Obama's policies in which way? Make them worse? How she can't go the other way, then she'd be Donald Trump. So it means she's going to make it even worse than him. That's if she remembers what she's supposed to do. And that's doubtful, as you well know, because she doesn't know how many times she fainted. So the point is, how do we uncouple this insanity? It is going to be really hard. You know, and I know, there was a UAC in the 1950s, and it's a dirty word of the most dirty of words, the House of Un-American Activities Committee, which was run by one of the great American patriots, Senator McCarthy. He has been completely decimated by the left. McCarthy was a tail gunner in World War II, one of the most dangerous positions you could ever have in an airplane, right? Belly gunner, B-24.
Target was the tail. That's what they attacked.
Listen what the left did to him. They called him, they mocked him and called him Tail Gunner Joe. In other words, they took his heroism and tried to turn it into a mockery. That was in the 50s, Alex, to show you who they were already, the communists. So what was McCarthy saying, this great war hero? He was saying that Hollywood had been infiltrated by communists. The journalists had been infiltrated by communists. Academia had been infiltrated by communists, and the government itself. Well, what happened was they had the hearings. They ruined him. They destroyed the man. And then what happened in the 1990s, I'm sure you remember the book, The Venona Papers, came out. It was a Soviet-Russian publication.
Turned out it was all true. The Russian documents came out, and it was worse than what McCarthy was saying.
Worse. It confirmed who in Hollywood, who in academia, who in government was, in fact, an operative of the Soviet Union. So there were subversives. UAC was exactly on target. I say the only way we can save this nation is not talking about it, but by rooting out the subversives in the United States of America.
If you look at the globalists, if you look at their leftists, they're saying the alt-right can't be tolerated. They're saying we need to be shut down and arrested. Hillary says she's going to shut down Breitbart. That means Drudge, you. They say they're bringing back fairness doctrine. They say they're coming after us. They're run by this foreign globalist Soros. Russia's already kicked him out. These are foreign globalists here overthrowing our country. So under the Constitution, these aren't even citizens. They don't have the rights. They're here overthrowing the system. To survive, we must go on the offensive. We must root them out. It's the only way to ever beat them. They are criminals. They are subversives. They are Saul Alinsky pledging to Lucifer. Please continue.
Now, the man behind all of it is George Soros. the most evil man on the planet, in my estimation. The absolutely most evil person the world has seen in modern times. You know, you don't have to hang people, electrocute them, put them in cages. You don't have to do the things that ISIS is doing to be evil. He's evil on a larger scale than the ISIS executioners are, because he's gutting the United States of America. He's trampling on our Constitution.
He helped fund the Arab Spring. He helped fund the Arab Spring. Hillary, all of them.
Hillary Clinton was the publicist and an actor, along with John Kerry.
I'd say she was the quarterback with Kerry and Obama.
She destroyed the Middle East. She owns that. How does the media, forget the media, why doesn't Trump put her on a cross with that
one? And by the way, Mr. Savage, Dr. Savage, that's not hyperbole. She literally destabilized 20-something countries that Al-Qaeda and ISIS are running around. Hundreds of thousands of dead Christians. They won't even let Christians out of the region. These people are demons, just like the true liberal Assange said, look, I've got the documents. The press is dead if she gets in. Our necks are in nooses. She's a demon. You must stop her.
I hear you. And I also saw who wrote the other day that Obama, the nice, slick, smooth, nice family man, has created the greatest surveillance state in the history of the world. And suddenly liberals are afraid of it because they understand what happens when the guillotine starts falling. First, it takes out your opposition. But as the world learned during the French Revolution, the guillotine has an unlimited taste for blood. And it doesn't stop with the enemies of the revolution. Then they turn on their own kind and start executing their own so-called counter-revolutionaries, as was done in the Soviet Union.
Always happens.
As was done in Cuba, as was done in Hitler's Germany. They kill their own.
The brown shirts.
And the guillotine keeps falling and cuts heads. It is the most thirsty instrument on earth. And that's why the left ought to step up and shut their fat mouths when we stand up to these monsters. These monsters need to be stopped or we're all finished. Left, right, and center. You mentioned a key word there, Google. For weeks, I've been railing against the monopolies that have emerged in America under Obama, the dictator. Google, Facebook, Microsoft, of course, had been there before. Look at these companies. They're violating the antitrust statutes of the United States legal system. There is an antitrust division of the U.S. Justice Department that does not touch Mark Zuckerberg, does not touch the Google boys, does not touch Bill Gates. And there's a reason, because they all support the globalist New World Order agenda. They support it to the nth degree. And I've been screaming that when Trump becomes president, he must reactivate and use the Justice Department to break up these monopolies and give other people a chance to build a business. And I make a point of Teddy Roosevelt, who was a populist, as you well know, and his campaign slogan was bust the trusts. The trusts in his day were Standard Oil, Rockefeller's railroads, an oil company that dominated railroads and dominated the oil business. They didn't give anyone a chance of emerging. If they did, they crushed them.
And it's the same globalist grandkids today that are running globalism.
Zuckerberg, $58 billion isn't enough for that pig. He needs to cut the wages of American workers and throw them out of the country and bring in Indians to work for one-third the wage. God bless India. God bless their intelligence. God bless India.
But we got to look out for us a little bit.
They belong in India. Let them rebuild their own economy and let them hire IT workers at a right salary. So, yeah, you want to talk about jobs. Why do you think, not you, I'm talking rhetorically.
Listener, sure.
Why do you think Trump is surging amongst the blue-collar, disenfranchised white male? Why? Because they've been dumped upon. They've been stepped upon. The Eddies, whose grandfathers defeated Hitler, the Eddies whose fathers died in the jungles of Vietnam, are being crapped upon by these vermin, these cowardly vermin, these sick, deviant perverts. I can't stand it. I'll get worked up, and I don't want to. I'm trying not to, Alex. This is the first interview I've done.
Wow.
For this book.
Thank you.
And Alex, I got to tell you, you're on the front lines. You're going to be around a lot longer than I am in the media and probably on this planet. And you're doing the job that needs to be done. And all I can say is, as the time comes to an end right here, when I say that Obama and the left are practicing a scorched earth policy, there's a reason for it. When an army retreated in the past, they burnt everything to the ground. They burnt the crops. They killed the livestock. They burned the barns.
Scorched
they burned
earth.
The houses. Is that not what's going on here with this left when they see an ascendant right, an ascendant American?
That's right. They're blowing it all up.
They're burning our pathways to survival. They're burning our internet. They want to burn radio. They want to burn any access.
They're trying to start a race war. They're saying kill the cops. They're getting away with everything.
I keep saying, Soros gave them $70 million to those street thugs. All we need now is Obama to turn them into his
round
well-funded shirt. Private army. He can deputize them and give them government arms as he did ISIS. And then you will have the young pioneers of the Soviet Union. You will have the Red Brigades. You will have the Red Brigades of Communist China frightening everybody in the society on a daily basis.
We cannot continue to rely only on our military in order to achieve the national security objectives that we've set. We've got to have a civilian national security force that's just as powerful, just as strong, just as well-funded.
Alex, we're that close to it all coming to that. Obama is not finished yet. He has several months left yet to burn it all down, Alex.
I agree. We've only got a minute left then. In your gut, you're a smart cookie, Dr. Savage. What do you expect them to pull?
Remember what George Bush did in the last few months of his regime? I was screaming and warning George Bush is a fiscal socialist. He's not through yet. Do you remember the housing crisis that followed? I expect that if it looks like Trump is going to win or grandma falls off the stage again for good and they replace it with Freddy from one of the nightmare movies, Kane, who can't win, I expect the worst. I expect them calling off the election. I expect martial law. I expect, if that is not possible, I expect a complete financial breakdown to create even further chaos. That's what I expect.
I've always been for free speech to the most radical level. The problem is they're all organizing and saying they want to shut down talk radio. They want to shut down Matt Drudge. They want to shut down Breitbart. Hillary says the alt-right, that means Michael Savage as the dean, does not have a right to exist. When you start hearing final solution, literal Nazi rhetoric that I don't have a right to exist, I've got a black heart, you're evil, Matt Drudge is evil, I'm done. Listen, you come here, you overthrow the country, you bring in radical Muslims, do you want to arrest me? The gloves are off, we're going to try you in front of a jury, then we're going to lock your asses up. You want it? We're going to find out who the traitors are. Go ahead.
Alex, you know, the left was famous at agitprop. I believe after this election, whoever wins, we need to have a people's tribunal and have mock trials of Hillary Clinton, John Kerry, George Soros, all of the names that we know are involved with destroying our sovereignty and going after our First Amendment. There's nothing prohibiting such agitprop.
You can be the prosecutor.
Who?
You.
No, I'm not good as a lawyer. I can't even imitate lawyers. But the thing is, Alex, listen, we got to slow down. There's a lot of work to be done because if Trump wins, and it looks like he could easily win unless they do one of two things, and I'm terrified of either of the options. One is the most horrible possibility. If it looks like he's going to beat her, you know they're not letting him get to the finish line. Let's let that hang in the air. Number two, let us say he wins. Well, what happens then? He is surrounded by neocons. They have already triangulated Trump. You saw that last week. He already brought in I think it was on your show last week, the former head of the CIA under,
Came out and criticized Trump.
The former head of the CIA under Clinton. He's using him as an advisor.
You're right. It was sure that's Woolsey.
Yes, Woolsey. Why would he choose him? I'm already concerned about the whole. Trump will be on my radio show today. By the way,
good.
Alex, he's scheduled to be on, and we're going to talk about terror. He's called for profiling today, incidentally, which of course is commonsensical, isn't it? Every cop in the world. I love the newspaper articles in the San Francisco area. They never show a perp unless he's got blonde hair and blue eyes. Can't find the perpetrator. You have to search.
By the way, in Sweden and Germany, they admit that even when it's a Muslim, they replace it with a blurred out image of a blonde haired German. And I interrupted you earlier when you were talking about how we go after subversives. When you're a multinational war criminal, former Nazi collaborator that's collapsed dozens of countries like George Soros, what do you do when a foreign power, a foreign group comes in and is trying to overthrow your country? What do we do to these subversives, just briefly? And then let's get back into, I agree, they're going to try to block Trump getting in. He's surging. His wave has turned into a tsunami. He's winning most of the battleground states. What are they going to do?
Why do you think blacks are coming over to him? Because they know she's a liar. I predicted 6 months ago that Hispanic males in particular will move to Trump.
Already happening.
For two reasons. I use common sense. I know these guys very well. They're a macho culture, number one. They don't like an old woman telling them what to do, let alone a woman. Number two, what does an Hispanic worker want? He wants what everyone else wants. I see them around construction sites every day. I bicycle by and talk to the pit crews, the foremen. These guys are building from 6 o'clock in the morning. They're the carpenters. They're the plumbers. They're the drywall. You know what I'm saying? And what do they have? The minute they get some money, they buy a pickup truck. They get some more money. They try to buy a little house in a far out suburb. I go to KFC on a weekend sometimes. Who do I see there? Hispanic men with their wives and their little daughters dressed up in a little dress. They just came from church. There's something beautiful there, Alex.
And they're driving American cars.
Yeah, but they don't want to be what they left behind in their hellhole, their third world polluted hellhole. They want the American dream. So who is their role model? They want to be like Donald Trump. They know they can't achieve that, but maybe they could be a little bit like him. Maybe some of his money and concept of making money will rub off on
them. Their grandkids could be like Trump. I mean, it took that long for Trump, too.
That's right. That's right. In other words, same in all of our families. My grandfather was an immigrant. Actually, my father was an immigrant. Sorry, not even my grandfather. I'm first-generation Americans. I keep saying I have one foot in the old world, one foot in the new. So I do recognize how hard it is to be an American if you just get here. But we were taught, learn English, work hard, you'll succeed. And if you don't, it's just this is the way it is. Then maybe
and Mr.
Will.
Savage, have you succeeded in everything? I mean, you've been successful in publishing, media, real estate, you name it.
It took me 30 years of struggle and being rejected. 1978, I earned my PhD from the University of California at Berkeley with straight A's. Not one university would hire me because I was the dreaded white male. They hired inferior. In every case, they hired women, minorities, and immigrants. And the ACLU proudly said, some Americans will have to put their lives on hold so others may move ahead. You don't know what it's like to shame yourself like I did. I had a sense of failure that no one will ever know. I don't want anyone to know. I was on the verge of suicide, but I wouldn't do it because of my children. I couldn't do that. I felt I had failed my ancestors, that after all this hard work, I couldn't even get a goddamn job teaching in a university because of the racism induced by the illegitimate, filthy scum called progressives.
But they forced you out into the real world where you dominated.
Academia can be the real world in some real science.
No, I mean, absolutely. But I'm saying they force you to build your own world and look how much bigger it was than in their world.
I'm the worst nightmare they ever had. I have more of an audience in 1 minute of my show than I would have in 1 year in a university.
That's what I'm saying. Exactly.
And again, that was Michael Savage with Alex Jones back on September 13th. Today's the, 28th? That's about 2 weeks ago. And you heard Michael Savage say, Facebook, they're going to take people down. We saw that happen now within the last 2 weeks. We saw that happen with Paul Joseph Watson's video, which they took down on YouTube. He then put it up on Facebook. This time, Facebook didn't get involved in the censorship. It was YouTube, but it's going to come around with Facebook. Alex told Michael Savage at the time, he said, they're going to come after you. They're going to shut you down. We saw that happen 2 days ago. Again, on the day that the big debate was going to happen. Michael Savage is talking about Hillary Clinton and what he believed to be her health issues. He was immediately shut down by the New York station. When he found out about that, he talked about that on his other 399 stations, and then they pulled the plug on all 399 and started running an older show and a rebroadcast. That's what we see happening over and over again. Now, tonight, we're going to talk more about this. We're going to talk about the Pope, his attack on journalism, saying that fear-mongering and gossip is a form of terrorism. See, if you talk about the terrorists, you are the terrorist. They bring in the terrorists, whether they're going to bring in 1% or 1/10 of a percent, as Michael Savage was talking about. Are they going to bring in 500 terrorists, 5,000 terrorists? We don't know. We don't know if it's 1% or 1/10 of a percent or 1/100 of a percent. But they're going to bring in the people. And if you talk about it or you talk about the terrorist events, according to the Pope, you are the terrorist. He says journalism based on gossip or rumors. What does that mean? That's what we always hear when they say conspiracy theorists. You're just a conspiracy theorist. You're just putting out rumors. You're just talking about gossip. No, we're talking about what is the official story and the gaps in the official story, the improbable official story. He says when you do that, that is a form of terrorism. He says you can kill a person with your tongue. It's even more true for journalists because their voice can reach everyone. This is a very powerful weapon. So join us tonight when the InfoWars Nightly News, we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about the FBI director. I think they should start calling him the director of the FIB, the FIB, because that's what we're seeing as he covers for Hillary. Many other subjects, and we have a special, we didn't talk about this, all shipping is free at InfoWarsLife.com at all the InfoWars store products. That's the way we support you as you support our operation. Join us tonight, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern, for the InfoWars Nightly News. I'll be hosting.